Tonight I want to talk to you about a radical subject, and you know, it's a very radical subject. And before I ever even begin to start with this, I want you to know, I want to preface this message tonight with the fact of the real thing of what God Himself did and modeled for us in Christ Jesus. Christ Jesus showed us the real gifts of the Spirit, not the ones that are from strong delusion, not the ones that are of a familiar spirits or that comes out of the realm of deception. Because believe me, I'm going to show you tonight that there are signs and wonders and miracles that come out of the realm of deception. And I want to talk to you tonight so that you can understand and discern the difference. But I want you at the same time recognize that Jesus models for us the real gifts of the Spirit that come out of the life of purity. If the manifestation, the demonstration of the Holy Ghost doesn't bring you to a place of holiness, if it doesn't bring you to a place of an encounter with a God who's holy, 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 that causes you to tremble with the fear of the Lord. I'm going to tell you right now, today my wife said, you know, she's on the way home and I tweeted it. She said, honey, where there's no fear of the Lord, there's no fear of hell. And that's true. Where there's no fear of the Lord, there is no concept of reality. You're just taken by what your eyes see and what your ears hear. The reality of it is, people, God has a genuine, glorious dimension of Himself that He wants to reveal through us. And that happens because we're willing to take a hold of the life of Jesus. Understand this. The life of Jesus Christ. This life, this sinless life of Jesus Christ, this purity of Jesus Christ, this humility of Jesus Christ, this wonderful realm that Jesus showed to us where He came revealing and manifesting the Father, that is everything that is contrary and opposed to the lust of the flesh, the lust of the eye, and pride of life. Because reality of it is today in the church, they're just like the people that were in Israel. They sit down at the table of the Lord and they rise up to play. They rise up with no holy fear. They go to commit fornication and idolatry and adultery and all uncleanness. And they participate in every wicked work. And they pretend as though there is no judgments for sin, that there is no consequence of disobedience. They have doctrines that completely eliminate that Father is a God of judgments. That he has said to us, flee from the wrath that is to come. Because it's coming. Yes. It's coming. Against all ungodliness and all sin. The movings of God draw people into the holies of holies. And you've got to understand that. The movings of God causes you to say, the response of your heart goes, I'm never going to allow demonic power in my life ever again. God is real. He is powerful. Everything He said is so true. You begin to tremble before the presence of a holy and an almighty God. That's what His signs and wonders do. False signs and wonders will do the opposite. It will confirm iniquity in your life. It will confirm it. It will validate it. And believe me, people, I'm not talking from the bottom shelf here. I'm not talking from living in a closet. God took me, like as it were, by the nape of the neck in 1994. And He caused me to be close friends with so many people, you know, in ministry, that we're doing great things in the earth in ministry. And I, as a young child, you know, I was around and seen a lot of different things from the different ministers that were alive during that period of time. And I've heard all the conversations about all the various different things, not all of them, but I've heard all of them that were around me. And you know, the reality of it is, people, is there's a whole lot of deception going down. There's a whole lot of the apostate church already in existence. We knew by revelation some years ago that the apostate church and the glorious church would exist simultaneously, but over as time grew to the end, the apostate church would become bigger and the glorious church would become smaller, even to the point that the glorious church would be hated by all nations, by all men, but there would be an apostate church that would be acceptable. True. True. And you know, I'm getting ready to release a book, and the anointing and the fire of God's on it, and I pray that you're praying with me. I pray that you're not just leaving it all to God as though, you know, you're not a partner in this. People just leave it all to God and they're busy with other things. They really behave themselves that they're not an heir and not a co-inheritor and not a partner. The people that believe that they're an heir, and it's not just a verse of scripture and something for you to raise your hand and say, amen, I agree with you. Huh? Because if I got up here and said, you're not an heir, and you're not a co-inheritor, you would boo me down. But how about you boo yourself down if you're not taking to heart those things that are part of being an heir and being a co-inheritor and being a partner with God? People want orthodoxy, but they seem to be completely out of sync with the responsibility of orthopraxy. They want it to sound right, they want it to preach right, they want it to declare right, but somehow they're willing to self-justify and not live it. We're not going to have any of that. Amen. I'm not going to allow it. Amen. I love you, I'm going to be patient with you, but I'm not going to allow it. Huh? So you're going to have to do, you're going to have to learn how to just, you know, love me and be patient with me while you get it right. Amen. Amen. You know, it works both ways. Praise God. So tonight, I'm not going to give you, as I read these things to you, I don't want you to get lost in the forest. I want you to see very clearly what I'm talking about. We're looking at something so simple to understand. We're looking at the model of Christ Jesus. We want to go after him. We want to follow him. We want to say what he said. If you add to what he said, the Lord said the plagues of this book will be added to you. Right. Why? Because if you add to it, you create a realm of deception. And the deception will result in you being a lost soul, not because the Lord has some kind of, you know, concern about his sentence structure. It's because if you add to it, you're going to bring something in that will open you up to a deception that will destroy your soul. Right. He says if you take away from it, your name will be taken out of the book of life. People that believe that once you're saved, you're always saved, they've got to crawl over all the verses of Scripture over and over again from Genesis 1:1 to Revelation 22:21. And let me just say this. I don't have a problem with that so long as you live without sin in your life and you walk in holiness and purity before God. Amen.
Amen.
But if you say that you can walk in ungodliness and wickedness and that you're still saved, no, you have the proofs that you're not saved.
Right.
And, you know, of course, the ancient Calvinists would simply say it's testimony that you've never been born again.
Right.
But as of recent, people then want to, you know, make it fit into their new doctrines. And so they have now made it to where that it's a greater deception. And now you can sin, do whatever you want to do, and you're never going to fall from the grace of God. And that's just a bunch of lies because, you know, Lucifer was a son in a place before God in relationship of great glory and majesty. And I'm telling you right now, he lost that place forever. And so did the angels that followed him, and so did Adam. And the list goes on. I started Genesis and before Genesis.
Right, right.
And I worked my way all the way through Revelation, and I could do it tonight. Almost every turn of the page of the Bible, I can prove to you that that's not true. This idea that once you're saved, you're always saved, because all it does is it gives Satan so much wiggle room and such a license for you to be able to walk around and just do whatever you want and have no fear of God. There's no fear of any kind of penalty for disobedience. Yeah. Suddenly, you know, as I read to you this morning in Romans chapter 6, it said very clearly 5 times that the wages of sin is death, that if you sin, you die,
yeah.
That it brings forth death.
Yeah.
I mean, and that's just one chapter. And so it's about time people get the fear of the Lord in their life and recognize, my goodness, there's a consequence for disobedience that you ill can pay.
Yeah.
You ill afford can pay. You hear me?
Yes. Yeah.
So I want to start off with tonight, I want you to just open up with me into 2 Thessalonians chapter 2. And I'm going to talk to you real quickly about the full-blown disposition of the Antichrist spirit. Now we know that John said the Antichrist spirit was already in the world, that it was already at work. And he described certain dimensions of that Antichrist spirit. But what we're going to do is we're going to look at the full-blown manifestation for just a moment of the Antichrist spirit that is going to come. And I want to do so because I want you to understand that this Antichrist spirit already works like this. There were already people who were able to do certain signs, certain wonders, certain things that looked like they were the testimonies of the signs and wonders and the miracles of God, that they were approved to God. But really what they were the ministers of Satan disguised to lead men away. It's a spirit of strong delusion. And so here is the full-blown manifestation of it. And actually, if you'll read this very carefully, you can see that Paul is saying that it already exists and it's already displayed to some degree, not in the full form of it, But he shows and he proves that it's already exists and already displays because, being displayed, because he tells the people he's talking to that they aren't like that. Now, if he would just say it's something totally in the future, that would be completely out of place for him to say they're not like that, or that he thinks better things of them. It would make no sense at all. He would just simply say, I know this isn't, you don't have to be concerned about it right now, but it's coming. But no, that's not what he says. So let's look and start right here in verse 9. Because that kind of just picks it up. And really, verse 11 is where I want to start, but just pick it up at 9. Even him, speaking of the Antichrist, whose coming is after the working of Satan. And this is very important that you understand what's meant by after the working of Satan, because Satan himself is transformed, as the scripture says, into a messenger of light, or is transformed into an angel from God, or a messenger that is speaking right out of the realms of the Holy Ghost on behalf of God the Father. Because that's what it means, whether you say angel or whether you say messenger. He's a messenger of God. He's come to deliver to you the true word of God. He is the one who deceives the nations. He is the one who wants to, in every way, he wants to overthrow God and subvert truth in every way. You can see it in part in his interaction with the Lord Jesus Christ. And as the Lord Jesus deals with him, Jesus could have said things about, listen, look, I know who you are. My goodness, I cast you out of heavens eons of years ago. No, what he did was he simply quoted the word to him and showed us, and he quoted a word to him that it really didn't even sound like it applied. You know what I'm saying? Turn these stones into bread. Now he's quoting, man should not live by bread alone, but by every word which proceeds out of the mouth of God. And he just went after it specifically with the word. But it's important for you to recognize that Satan is the one who deceives the whole world. He's going to, you've seen in Revelation chapter 12, is the one that's cast down out of heaven, out of the realms of the unseen, in the place of spiritual wickedness. It is a realm separated right now, different from what it was in the days of Daniel. I don't want to go on that. We have proofs for that, because Jesus pulled principalities and powers and might, made an open shame of them. He through death destroyed him that had the power of death, that is the devil. He abolished death and brought life and immortality to light through the gospel. Yeah. So that's a lot of verses of scripture that I hope you understand or know, and can it can give reference to everyone I just quoted. And if you can't, see me later, because I want to help you. I want to help you give yourself to the study of the word, because it doesn't take that long. And besides that, when you give yourself to the study of the word and you're doing based upon that which the Holy Ghost supplies, he brings into our remembrance these things. He said, Lord, bring these things into my remembrance. I don't want to forget these things. I want to be able to supernaturally quote your word. Hallelujah. And he'll always be giving us his word right on time for every situation. And there's no authority or power greater than his word. Amen?
Amen.
Hallelujah. The word made flesh and the written word that describes everything about the word made flesh. For the word made flesh also, the living word, reveals everything that the written word describes. So the full revelation of the written word is found in the manifest living word. The logos, the sum total of all existence. That's what God used to capture the attention of all of the Greeks and all of the Greek philosophy that had absolutely penetrated most of the known world. He said, I'm going to tell you the sum total and essence of everything. The revelation of God, declaration of God, definition of God was with God and was God. So now he's just blown the Jews away, who's having a problem with their monotheistic theology, because he just said he is God and he's with God. So now there's certainly two. He's got the Greeks and he's got the Jews, and they're all going, what? And he said, and he's made flesh, and we beheld the glory as the glory of the only begotten Son of God, full of truth and full of grace. And here he says, and you know, of course, John says later on, he that denies the Son and denies the Father is a liar. This is the spirit of Antichrist. So the spirit of Antichrist could work in a very subtle deception to begin with. And there's a lot of people got a lot of things. They got to climb over the word of God. They only want to pick and choose whatever verses of scripture suit their particular bias and theology and ideology and philosophical Christian tradition. And it's about time we get over here into the written word and recognize that our soul is at stake, where the Lord said, search the scriptures, for in them ye think ye have salvation. There's a lot of people running around. The Mormons believe they're more right than we are, the Jehovah's Witness, and the list goes on. So who's really right? those who give heed unto the word of God and have the proof and the evidence of those things which God described, beginning with the wellspring and going on the way to the rivers with the flow of God, with the proofs of reality that now we have been born again and do not sin. Because John lays it down in the first epistle in a way that everybody almost in the Christian community today would take me and stone me if they could. If they had power, they'd throw me in prison. Praise God for the Constitution. It's the only thing that's holding them back. No, it brought a different community. It brought a different liberty to the church that the church had never known. By and large, the church began to experience a freedom as a result of something that was birthed in the Great Awakening called the Constitution of the United States of America that began to protect us with a First Amendment, hallelujah. I don't care much about the second, but the bottom line of it is the freedom also to pursue the living God, hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
It's more than freedom of religion, praise God. That's the best word they can come up with that covers it. And you know, we have, and I'm so thankful for it. I'm so blessed for it. God gave it, and only God can take it away.
Amen.
And the church flowing in revival in the move of the Spirit, it sustains it, and no man.
Amen.
Praise the name of the Lord. So, here in 2 Thessalonians, even whose coming is the Antichrist, which is, once again, speaking of Antichrist spirit as well, the working of Satan, deception, say deception. It's not him coming with a pitchfork, breathing fire with fangs coming out and blood dripping off of his chin, you know, with horns and all red and everything. It's Satan coming with deception as an angel of light saying, I got the word of God right here for you.
Yeah.
Because there's a misunderstanding of all of this. It comes with the working of Satan. It's the deceiving power. And here's a very important thing that you got to understand. With lying, with all power and signs and lying wonders. So he comes with a deception, and we can look at it on the level. If you turn, for example, don't do it right now. I don't know if I'm going to turn there, because if I go over there, I'll probably get lost for a couple hours. I don't know if I'll get back. I might go over there if I can feel like I can just stop off for a few minutes. But you go into Revelation chapter 16, and you discover what the power of Satan and the miracles and the lying wonders that are able to be accomplished by the Antichrist and by the false prophet. And that's the full magnitude of it. Because I'm going to tell you right now, beast worship, people misunderstand it. It's far more than a mark of slavery. It is such an act of debauchery. It is such an evil and wicked act of the worst defilement of humanity that those people can never be saved. It's so blasphemous and so defiling to the being. Yeah. And if you have any propensity to give way to temptation, it is going to be alluring thing that is so erotic and so you're so unable to resist it that it will lure everyone in who has no resistance to the devil. And there's only one area of resistance to the devil, and it's believing the word of God. So if you don't have any word of God at all, you just forget about it. If you're taken out by temptation right now, you will not stand at all. 1 second. Because there is now no more limitation to deception. There is no more limitation to iniquity. It is the full, unveiled, unbridled power of anomia. The hinder of it is gone, and the full mystery of it is revealed. Yeah. That's what God says. And we can understand a little bit about it. We know that Satan, because there weren't the same limitations on him as there is now, that he was able to deceive the whole world in 1,565 years, to where we read in Genesis chapter 6 that the imaginations of the men's heart was wicked continually. It was only wicked, and it grieved and repented God that he had made man. Satan had so worked his wickedness in man's life that they lost all similitude of God. Somebody said, I don't believe God exists. I'm going to tell you right now, if you live one minute in a realm where God does not exist, you would be totally insane inside of 1 minute. You would lose all love. You would lose all hope. You would lose all life. You would lose everything that is good. It's the mercies of God that allows His Son to shine upon the just and the unjust. Amen. Amen. And it's His Son. And that's provable. Amen. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Everybody else trying to figure out where it comes from. I know where it comes from, and I can prove it. I can prove it. With signs and wonders and miracles, I can prove it. With a very clear declaration of an authority that is above all authority, a wisdom that is above all wisdom, a knowledge that is above all knowledge, an understanding that is superior to all understanding.
Yes.
Bring it on. Bring it on. People are willingly ignorant because they do not want to serve God. They hate God. They place a hatred upon God. They love unrighteousness and they love the works of unrighteousness. And there are many signs and wonders going on. And you've heard me testifying about this for a number of years. There are many signs and wonders going on right now in the name of Jesus Christ that are nothing more than antichrist spirit. It is the power of working of Satan. It is lying signs and wonders. And it does not produce true repentance. It does not produce the true miracle of change to where you're a new creation. All things are of God. Everything that is old has passed away. The old man destroyed. And everything that now exists in our life is that which belongs to the realms of the Holy Ghost. They don't have the proof and the reality and the witness of being born again in the spirit of holiness. Yeah. And what they have is then substitute doctrines that will supposedly they can prove from the word that gives to them some kind of explanation or some kind of doctrine or proofs, false proofs that somehow they can have these things going on in their life and be right with God. And they hate people like me. Verse 10 says, and with all deceivableness of unrighteousness. And I'm getting ready to take you someplace here in a minute that's really going to help you. I'm really going to flesh this out. Okay, because really what it is, it's a deception that works in such a way that it allows unrighteous behavior and makes a person feel like that they're okay, that there's peace, that they're right with God, when in reality, they are everything that God's wrath is set against. Okay, with all deceivableness of unrighteousness in them that perish because they receive not the love of the truth that they might be saved. The love of the truth. The word of God is truth. Christ Jesus is life. What he modeled for us is the Son. The one that he said, if you want to be my disciple, you must come and imitate me. This wonderful love of the truth that tells us to imitate God. To be holy just as God is holy. To be pure just as he is pure. To walk in and be perfect just as he is perfect. And recognizing that he empowers us to do it. Rather than creating doctrines that say, no, we don't have to do that. And nobody can do that. And even saying that that is a lie. It overthrows the doctrines that says, we are righteous even as he is righteous. That everyone that does righteousness is righteous even as he is righteous. These proofs, and he that sins is of the devil. They forsake the proofs that are laid down. And no holiness or no fear of God is able to work within their spirit because they've overthrown the truth with their lies, with their deceptions. And in the midst of that, Satan begins to work his power with lying signs and wonders so that they can begin to get more men to follow after their pernicious ways than to their same deception because they say, oh, I feel the presence of God. And I'm going to tell you right now, I have been around people that are full of the devil and they can actually produce, as it were, with their ministry, what everybody would probably say is they feel, oh, great anointing in the place. If it isn't the word of God, if it doesn't result in calling you out of unrighteousness and calling you out of darkness and calling you out of sin and calling you out of wickedness and calling you out of every worldly thing, it is a false spirit at work. It's all deceivableness of unrighteousness. Amen. Then working in those people who love not the truth. I love the truth. Where will I find it? In his word.
Word.
In his word. And I don't care what the signs and wonders are. If the signs and wonders do not testify to his word, I don't care how many times they're saying Jesus. Because they can do signs and wonders and say Jesus, 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 and all it does is result in people being demonized and ultimately being lured in to a greater passion and a lesser resistance against fornication, against immorality, against uncleanness, against all kinds of wickedness that just floods them. They lost their resistance. I've watched it happen. I was in a meeting back in 1995, 95, and I was with some men of God. The first day that a ministry opened its doors, it became a very popular ministry. Went in there, and it was like you could feel this what seemed to be a weighty presence of God, but it wasn't. And one of the men of God said with me, stood by me, and he said, "I just saw a vision." He said, "I just saw a white serpent, very small and subtle, crawl up into the tree of life." And as he said it, he gave the interpretation. He said, this will result in the greatest blasphemy of the Holy Ghost that has ever been known to the Church of the Lord Jesus Christ since the Church of the Lord Jesus Christ was born 2,000 years ago. And what we've seen it is we've seen it grow. Now people are toking the ghost. And supposedly now they're getting in the anointing and they're drinking the wine. And now they're getting drunk in the spirit. And all kinds of blasphemies, and it's going wild, and it's getting weirder and weirder and more flaky, and none of them have a testimony of pure living. Rather, they go into the cave after the meeting and have shots of vodka and sit around and smoke big stogies of marijuana. And it's happening right now. And then they come out in front of you and you go, "Oh man, listen to them, all wonderful." Yeah, but behind their doctrine is no power to live godliness and holy lives. Behind, they have the power, they have a form of godliness, but they deny the power of walking in purity and holiness and walking in a place separated from the world. They basically give a license to everybody to participate with all kinds of worldly things and demonic influences. And, you know, I'm just waiting on the Lord to release me to start naming names. I'm in trouble already enough for just telling you to live, that you've got the calling, you to, just reading Romans chapter 6 and just letting Romans chapter 6 speak for itself. I'm already a condemnation preacher, because now if you preach against any form of sin and you call people out because of sin and you say that sin will result in damnation, this sin will result in death, that sin is cooperation with unclean spirits and demon spirits, exactly what the scripture says, as I've read them to you this morning, you are a condemnation preacher. And nobody wants any condemnation in their church because it don't sell.
Wow.
Nobody's coming back. Everybody's going to leave. They leave by the hundreds in bigger churches. But I truly believe that, you know, in saying all this, I truly believe that people are going to get sick of it. I mean, the Pentecostal movement is basically being ruined. It's being ruined. It's being trashed with all kinds of compromise. Major decisions have been made by the denominations within the framework of Pentecostalism that has just absolutely abdicated a sin and iniquity. It's true. It's true. I tell you right now, if Mariah Woodworth Eder was to be raised from the dead and come walk into any Pentecostal church, she would walk right back out. She'd walk in and say, "Oh, wrong place. I ended up in a bar. I don't know how I got here. Okay. I ended up in a nightclub. I don't know what I'm doing here. Who are these people? I'm out of here." Smith Wigglesworth, anybody just from 80 years ago. And go just read what they wrote. The church cannot even relate to what brought the great awakening. I laugh when people hearing all these people who are just a bunch of compromisers, got all kinds of sin and filth and compromise with the world and going on in their life, and they're talking about a great awakening. No. You can't even relate to what Jonathan Edwards said when he said, "Your foot is about to slip." Right. When he quoted the scripture in Exodus and said, "Your foot is about to slip." Huh? And in that was the theme verse of scripture that he used in a sermon titled "Sinners in the Hands of an Angry God." And the earth shook under the weightiness of him reading such a radical call to repentance. But what was going on in the earth is that people were hearing from preachers, "You cannot live wrong and die right." Now you're hearing from preachers, "You can live wrong and die right. You can even commit suicide and be okay."
That's true.
I was talking to a person the other day. Yeah, they were going to commit suicide so they could go be with Jesus. I said, "You got to be kidding me." "Oh, yeah." I said, "There's no way you're going to go be with Jesus." And the person said, "Well, you can't lose your salvation." I said, "Oh, yes, you can." And as soon as they did, the wall came up. The wall of deception. Because people live in that. Because I'm going to tell you right now, you listen to me, you Baptist, you demon-possessed Baptist, you listen to me right now. Because your blasphemy against the Holy Ghost is resisting the Holy Ghost and not wanting to cooperate with the ministry of Jesus is as bad as Satan coming with his lying signs and wonders. You're worse off, as far as I am concerned, and God is my witness, and the testimony is in the Word of God. that you are actually in a worse state. And then those that stood before the Lord Jesus said, in your name we cast out devils and did signs and wonders. And he said, depart from me, you workers of iniquity. Because I'm going to tell you right now, you don't have power against sin either. Because you've been looking at the same immorality. And you know who I'm talking to right now. I got a bigger audience out there than there is in here. I got to spend more time there. It's just true. It's true. And I'm talking to you too. It's just that the Holy Spirit wanted me to direct it right at that camera. Some people looking at me right now. And I could call some names right now. I'm not going to do it. Because sometimes you start calling names in the wrong context and people, you lose people because they're sitting there trying to figure out what name it was. Well, is that the guy I know? Is that the girl I know? People, listen to me. The reality of it is the proof is, are you an overcomer or not? Huh? If you've been born again, you don't sin. Right. You don't practice it. Right. Huh? If you've been born again, you've received the power and the authority and the ability to live in the life of God. God's come inside of you, and there's a greater one on the inside of you than all the lying spirits and all the lying power and all the power of Antichrist and all the subversive spirits and all the spirit of the world, the lust of the flesh, the lust of the eye, the pride of life. You come out from among them. You're separate. You're not going to participate with it. You're not going to partake of it. People allow themselves to be involved in things that they know is too big for them. My goodness, if you're being overcome with some kind of sin, get out of its way. It's like being, if a Mack truck's coming at you, get out of its way. Don't just stand there. I can't help it. I'm going to be hit. Get out of the way. Lord Jesus, people need to be healed. And then verse 11, the Lord says, and for this cause, God shall send them a spirit to send them strong delusion that they should believe a lie and be damned. Now listen to me, I want you to understand something. I've had so many people say to me, how can so-and-so do so many signs and wonders and miracles and all the time they were practicing some form of new age or witchcraft or some kind of adultery or fornication, going into a meeting, you know, supposedly having signs and wonders and miracles, and going out that night and hanging out, and they brought with them on the airplane over two people from, you know, I hate to even say it, but two Playboy girls, brought them with them. So when the meeting was over, they went and committed all kinds of adultery and immorality, got drunk, had a party. They went back to the meeting the next morning. Everybody felt the anointing. What? No, that goes on. I know names. I know numbers. I know places. And I know dates. It goes on. And people are just overwhelmed. Oh, yeah, praise. Oh. And then there, the worship song you're singing with somebody got that worship song while they were smoking dope, man. While they were smoking dope because it's the herb that God gave. Huh? Their little sweet weed and their beer. And that they got, and then they all high, all carried away with some demon spirit. And now they're going to sing a little song to Jesus, and everybody's going to think it's so wonderful. It's crazy. I'm trying to make it look crazy. Because it is crazy. Amen. And the reality of it is, I'm not making something up. I'm not saying something, you know, theoretical that I think happened. I'm saying things that I know happened. Some things that I've seen firsthand, some things that I've witnessed, and some things that people that I know and that are very close to me have witnessed, I witnessed of. It's just like, what are we going to do with this thing? Right. Listen, I'm going to tell you right now, it was never God the Holy Ghost. It was Satan. It was a spirit of strong delusion. People didn't want to hear. They left my meeting telling them they can't walk in sin and be right with God. And they left all upset and went over to another meeting. And because they wanted that, they wanted to be justified in their wickedness, God sent them a spirit of strong delusion so they would believe a lie. Just like he sent Israel quail because they didn't want manna. And he sent them leanness to their soul. And they died in the wilderness. Yep. Period. You got to understand me. We're going to have to wake up here. Yep. You know, we're not going to be scared of signs and wonders and miracles. We're going to do them. Yep. We're not going to act like the deadhead Baptist who walk around trying to, you know, speak against the anointing and the Holy Ghost, and they got more sin in their life than anybody. Proof you've been born again is that you've overcome the wicked one. Amen. You've overcome the world. And you've overcome sin. Amen. If you haven't started, you better get with it. And if you're in doubt, you better shout till it goes out. Right.
Huh? And if you don't believe God's heard you yet, you better get on your knees and start pleading and take a hold of something Amen. Before it's forever too late. Because if you got any belief that there is a God that's listening to you, you will have such a response.
True. Amen.
Otherwise, it's just nothing but a product and an expression of doubt, unbelief. Amen. And maybe even worse. When you look at Romans chapter 1, Romans chapter 1 talks about lesbianism. Romans chapter 1 talks about homosexuality, and it says that God gave them over. Mm-hmm. He gave them over to all of this deception. He gave them over to this power of wickedness because they were unwilling to respond to the truth. They were unwilling to respond to Holy Ghost conviction. They're unwilling to retain the knowledge or the word of God and respond to it. They said, no, they threw it down. They cast it down, so God cast them down. People say, oh, there's nothing about homosexuality in the Bible. There's people preaching right now. People preaching right now. Some of them just recently died. They died. Pedophiles. Pedophiles. People sending them their money, praising God for all the works that they've done, and they're pedophiles and alcoholics. Fact is provable. It's proven. Crazy things. And people saying, oh, look at all the great things that they're doing. Look at no. All that's going on is laced in what they're doing is such a deception and such a compromise that God is the Lord Jesus is puking. Because it's such lukewarmness. It's such compromise. And that's what he said about lukewarmness. It'll spew you out. It's true. It's not funny. Because people are caught away with it. There was a prophet of God saying to me one day, oh, I'm sending my money to so-and-so. I said, you are. I said, you know what they're doing? And I read the riot act to him. He said, do you know this? I said, yes, I do. Cute prophet. You're sending your money. You should have some more. If you're a prophet, what's wrong? What's wrong? How are you so deceived? You run down the facts. He ran down the facts and found out the truth. He's sending his money to a pedophile. It's pretty sick, ain't it? You better wake up. You better wake up and better take a hold of God. You better recognize there's more going on here than what seems to be. There's got to be some people who's going to start walking right and living right. People that are going to start taking a hold of the reality of what God has given to us. He paid such a high price for us to have this holiness and this purity. He paid such a high price for us to have this righteousness, to have this heavenly realm, to be the temples of the living God, which God himself has come to dwell, where God himself with all of his power and his might and his glory has come and now abiding within our being. To perfect everything that concerns us and develop us in all of his character. The Lord gives us a space of time to repent. But I'm going to tell you right now, he's got fire in his eyes while he's given the space of the time. Go look at him in Revelation chapter 1. He's standing in the midst of the church and he doesn't look all lovey and sweetie. He's got fire in his eyes. His eyes are a flame of fire. And there's a sharp two-edged sword coming out of his mouth. Huh? Go look again. He's standing in the midst of his church. That's what he looks like right now in the midst of his church. You better tremble. I tremble. I tremble. Because I got to look at him. I got to look at him in Revelation chapter 1. And then I heard what he said to seven churches. Huh? The only one I want to be in is Sardis. Hey, it might have been all the fanfare and big things and great things happening over to Ephesus, but I'd have rather been in the small church of Sardis. Because he had nothing bad to say about them. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. They were being afflicted and tormented and persecuted and unwanted. But he said, don't you worry about it. I got something good for you. It's coming. It's coming. Just wait till you see your place in my kingdom.
Amen.
Basically is what he was saying. Tell the church at Ephesus, they might have been the big church with all the great stuff and all the wonderful, star speakers coming. But he said, I'm going to tell you right now, you repent quickly.
Yes.
I'll remove your candlestick.
Amen.
I hate to be the church. The Lord said, I'm going to come and fight against you with a sword of my mouth. Yeah. I'm going to come blot your name out of the book of life. And his eyes are on fire. We think he's just a lowly lamb, just loving everybody. Just this little quiet, accommodating, jovian fella.
No.
I mean, these things are holy.
Yeah.
He's more lit up than any cherubim protecting the way of the tree of life.
That's right. Yeah.
Hello.
Yeah.
He's the door into the holies of holies.
Amen.
The cherubim, just look at the cherubim, how they're lit up over the tree of life, or just something that just belongs to Pops.
Right.
How much more do you think that Christ Jesus is inflamed over the entrance into the holies of holies?
Yes.
Get out your religion.
It's good.
It's nothing to do with this Bible. Has nothing to do with the one who bore our sins in the tree in his own body. It's nothing to do with the one who's holy, 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 who's one who's the beginning and the end, the Alpha and the Omega, the everlasting to the everlasting, the Almighty God, the Most High.
Amen.
Nothing to do with him.
Amen.
You're not going to live wrong and die right. As you live, you'll die. You live your life participating with devils. Hang on, baby. You're about to hang out with those things for eternity. It's going to get real bad. Your hell is going to be turned into fire. Your hell is going to turn into flames. Where the flame is not quenched, neither does the soul die. And when Jesus talked more about hell in the New Testament than he talked about heaven, and there's preachers standing around right now with big church saying right now, that hell doesn't exist. Hello, people. Behold, the apostasy is well underway.
Yes.
It was a number of years back I said, I had heard about it all my life, but all of a sudden I seen it. There's the apostate church. Here we are. Now it's full-blown apostate church.
Yes.
It's happening all around.
Yes.
It's a time, as Paul talked about in 2 Timothy chapter 4, having itching ears, heaping into themselves teachers, having itching ears. Those who cannot endure sound doctrine, as he said in 1 Timothy chapter 4, seducing spirits that would come in the last days, how they would go and lead away and deceive many. And what is the most effective way of deceiving? One of the most effective ways of deceiving is with signs and wonders and miracles. That's how the Mormon church got started. Joseph Smith did signs and wonders and miracles. He was the only one in his time that they even seen anybody doing signs, wonders, and miracles. And so he must be the prophet of the Lord. No, he wasn't. He was a seducing spirit. He was a spirit of strong delusion. How many proofs do you need? These things didn't just start just because somebody had a new idea and everybody bought in the idea. No, there were supernatural things going on. And no, it wasn't God. And no, they didn't have the anointing and lose it. No, it was just, it was the devil from the beginning.
Yes.
A setup. It was a setup to lead men away from God to make compromises because they felt that they had the tokens that were being confirmed from heaven that their iniquity and that their state was now being condoned by the Father. No, you should have read the Word.
Yes.
You should have read the Word.
Yes.
Jesus said, Jesus exalted the Word of Moses and the prophets above being raised from the dead. He said, if they can't believe the authority and the power, really is what he's saying, they can't believe the supernatural thing that exists and resides within what the words that the prophet spoke, because it's his word, it's spirit, it's life, it's living, it's powerful. If they can't believe the word that was spoken by the prophets and by Moses, which endures forever and cannot pass away, then they will not believe though someone be raised from the dead.
Right.
So therefore, when somebody is raised from the dead and they're believing something, And it is proven to be not the word at all. It's proven to be a mixture of the word. Understand what I said, as I said at the very beginning, I'm not saying that real signs and wonders and miracles are not the calling card for the kingdom. Here they are. But real signs and wonders and miracles causes you to encounter a holy God that causes you to fall before his face and recognize how sinful and how evil your life has been, and it brings you to a place of trembling and repentance and the fear of the Lord. You've just encountered God and you become aware of the awesomeness of who he is, and you there in awe of God. Sin not.
Amen.
You know? Hello.
Amen.
Let me get back over here real quickly, see if I can get this done before it gets too late. I just wanted to real quickly give you, for those of you who have homosexuals coming to you, and it's not just homosexuals, it's people that's watching pornography. Persons watching pornography is just as bad off as a homosexual. And I can say a person that's speaking evil against those who are anointed of God, they're just as bad off as a homosexual. Huh? You know, a person that's constantly running their mouth with against other people and causing division and causing envy, they're just as bad off. No difference. It's all the same works of the flesh, 17 works of the flesh, that the Lord said, you do these and you're not saved. Galatians chapter 5, he says, you do any of these and you're not saved. He said it. And I don't need to go read it again. He said it a unique way. He said, you have no part in the kingdom of God nor inheritance with the Lord Jesus Christ. He also said the same thing in Ephesians chapter 5. And he said the same thing in 2 Corinthians chapter 6 and 1 Corinthians chapter 6. And the list goes on. And I mean, the whole epistle of John. I mean, it just goes on and on and on. Of how many times the Lord emphasizes this. And yet people say, no, but I went to the altar and I just love the Lord more than anybody I know. Well, I tell you right now, you may think you do, but your deeds prove you to be wrong. Your deeds to prove to you that if you're right, they that do righteousness are righteous even as he is righteous, and they that sin are of the devil. It's just that simple. So maybe somebody did not define sin for you. Maybe someone did not define righteousness, but righteousness produces the fruits of holiness. That's what God says. It's a righteousness. It is not an imputed righteousness only. It's an imparted righteousness that is effectively at work in us, producing within our lives the evidence of the very nature and character of God, or the fruits of holiness. That's what, it's one of the chief themes of Romans chapter 6. Amen. Hello. People, come on, let's just get right with this program and understand that you have a responsibility. They that believe the gospel shall be saved, and they that do not believe shall be damned. And I'm giving you the gospel. It is good news to tell you. Listen, don't walk across the street. There's a sniper on the building and he's killing everybody that walks by. You would thank me, oh, thank you so much. I was just getting ready to go over there. You wouldn't be saying to me, oh, man, you just totally messed up my day. That's not good news. That's bad news. I can't believe you told me. That's the way people want to try to act like, you know, telling people, flee from the wrath to come. They want to put that on the same level as the sniper across the street. Or letting people know, listen, you have an opportunity to believe. If you do not believe, you'll be damned. It's your choice. I tasted and seen God's good. Amen. Some people need to go run down the whole gauntlet of wickedness before their eyes are open. But many people aren't going to make it to the other side of the gauntlet. That's the problem. Many people aren't going to make it to the other side of the gauntlet. If you think for 1 minute, you listen to me. If you think for 1 minute that you can deny God and live some kind of a life, I'm telling you right now, demons abhor that space. They will come and claim your soul in short order. People going to all caught up in depression and going to go and commit suicide and then try to tell me they don't believe God exists. What are you talking about? You living in hell.
Yeah, that's right.
I live in a place, I love life. And I got it abundantly. And I'm blessed coming in, I'm blessed going out. I have the fruits of what God said in his word. Why? Because I demand it of myself. God said, don't do it. And I say, yes, sir, I'm not going to do it. Because I just discovered that if you obey God's word, you get blessed.
Right.
You obey God's word, you find yourself not heaping upon yourself self-destruction.
Right.
You go with your own opinion, your own idea of it. It's going to be bad every time. You obey God's word and you're blessed. You're going, how did I get so blessed? Because you took heed unto his word. You simply obeyed his word.
Right.
He knows how life works. He invented it.
Right.
Hello. Do it God's way.
Yes.
Holy Spirit, take control. And you know, you heard me tell you this morning, when we talk about being servants of sin, that means you're under the control of sin.
Right.
And nobody seems to have any problem with that. But then all of a sudden, you're servants of righteousness. And I tell you, by the virtue of the same terminology, now you're under the control of righteousness. And everybody's going, oh, they're gasping.
Yes.
Why? Because they don't measure up.
Right.
You don't measure up. The plumb line has been set, and you out of plumb, baby. You are totally, that ain't even a foundation. That ain't going to hold up for nothing.
Right.
That's going to crack before you pour it. It's worse than the Leaning Tower of Pisa. That thing ain't going to stand one windstorm. And the Lord proved it. He said, you can know whether or not you're in the truth, whether or not you respond to this wonderful salvation, because the wind and the waves and the storms and every assailing thing that Satan and circumstances can throw at you come in your way, and you stand firm, solid upon the rock. You've not moved.
Amen.
But the opposite is true for those who are whose lives are not in Christ Jesus. The stuff comes and they're taken over by the temptation, carried away by the devil at his own will. Proof! You're not right with God. You've not been born again. You do not have the new creation. Proof! Get right. People put the plumb line down. All of a sudden, they quit playing around, constantly having excuses. Because all I found is giving people a little bit of an excuse, they run with it for the rest of their life. It's about time we just put the line down in the clarity and the solid definition is what God says.
Amen.
Somebody comes to me and says, well, I've been falling in sin. I must not be saved. I'm going to just respond to them from now on saying, you must not be. And leave it there. If somebody told me I must not be, and I'd already said I must not be, I'll tell you right now, I'd find a way to be.
Amen.
I'd get a hold of God. Yes. I'd start getting real with God.
Yes.
Instead of trying to have somebody make me feel better. Oh, it's going to be all right. I promise you it's going to be all right. God loves you. It's going to be okay. Just press in. Now get right.
Amen.
Get right.
Amen.
Get right.
Amen.
Got things out of order in your life, and you come to terms with the thing, I'll tell you right now, goodness of God will lead you to repentance. You'll cry out till the real thing happens, till the glory fills your soul, and the presence of the Lord becomes more important to you and cherished to you, by you than anything else. I'm not going to hell. I'll tell you right now, the one thing I know, you say I know a lot of things. The one thing I know is that heaven is real and hell is real. The one thing I know is that God, the Holy Ghost, Christ Jesus, the Father, they're real. And that Satan and his hordes are real. They are real. And there are proofs, so by the billions of proofs and evidence. And anybody who's willing to take a moment of reality will admit it. There's too much evidence. There's too much evidence for life and death. How many people got to die before it's proven to you that there is a death? How many babies got to be born before it's proven to you that there is a life? How much death, torment, and destruction, sickness, and disease has got to take place before you're ever going to believe that there is a death? How much healing and miracles and blessings have got to take place before you're going to believe that there is a life?
That's good.
How many curses have got to take place before you're going to believe there is a curse? How many blessings have got to take place around you before you're going to believe that there's a blessing? Get a hold of the blessing.
Yes.
Get a hold of the life.
Yes.
Get a hold of the cure. The Lord says, I set before you life and death. I set before you good and evil. Choose life that you may live. As you've yielded your members as servants or under the control of death unto iniquity, to work iniquity. So now yield your members as servants or under the control of righteousness. And your fruit, holiness.
Amen.
Same verse of scripture.
Yeah.
Just now in a more living way. When it's quoted. When it's said by Paul. And the reference being Romans chapter 6 verse 18. But I wanted to read this to you real quickly. In verse 25. You look here. Verse 24 of Romans chapter 1. Just let me show you this real quickly. Wherefore God also gave them up to uncleanness through the lust of their own heart. See. Not because of any other reason, but they just stayed with the lust of their own hearts. They just stayed in what they wanted. They just continued to nurture sin and iniquity. They wouldn't turn back. They continued to give themselves to all kinds of evil, which we are saturated with right here in Southern California. They wouldn't resist it. Having their eyes, as Peter said, and 2 Peter chapter 3 verse 18, having eyes full of iniquity, they could not cease from sin. He says it right here. He says, wherefore God also gave them up to uncleanness through the lust of their own hearts, to dishonor their own bodies between themselves. Sexual immorality. Huh? And really, the specific note is homosexuality, who changed the truth of God into a lie and worshipped and served the creature, having a love for pleasure more than a love for God. The list goes on. Creature being themselves, being man, more than the Creator, who is blessed forever. Amen. For this cause God gave them up unto vile affections. For even their women did change the natural use into that which is against nature. Lesbianism. And likewise also the men. Homosexuality. People say, well, there's nothing about homosexuality in the scripture. Now you know. And the one thing that I want people to do in Holy Ghost meetings is I want them to get grounded in the Word where they can turn to the scripture. When somebody starts telling them a bunch of nonsense, you can lay it out. When all of a sudden somebody's working deceit, lying, signs and wonders, and you look into this thing and you're just there and you're just worshiping the Lord, something seems a little bit off, because God always shows people something's off. Yeah. And then you investigate and you find out people around you to say they're going to go out drinking, they're going to go out nightclubbing. There's one of the biggest churches right here in San Diego. They got all upset at Allie because Allie was just ministering on the fact that you're not supposed to go dancing and nightclubbing. Oh, you religious girl. Oh, you just religious. And that's where everybody's at. They leave here and go over there. Huh?
Yes.
Listen to me.
Yes.
And I'm going to tell you right now, it's in that context that Satan will do lying signs and wonders. He will come as a messenger of light, and people will have proofs and verifications that validate their iniquity, because God, because of their choices, sent them a spirit of strong delusion, of great deception. A delusion is a mixture. It's where the Word of God and truth is diluted. You understand? It's a delusion. It is a deception that is a result. It is a result of a mixture. Who wants to drink pure water mixed with swampy, muddy water? And we could sit, slurp, slurp. Oh, this was so wonderful. It was like how, you know, I got over in this little pool where I didn't see any mud, and oh, it was delicious. What? Didn't even go over there, people. I'm like, come on. Well, there is a fountain, praise God. The pure flow of the spirit of holiness, no demon spirit in it. And what's going to have there is the power of holiness is going to be there. In the meeting, you're going to get some fear of God. You're going to get some consecration. You're going to get some persuasion. You're going to get some resolve. You're going to get some holy knowledge. You're going to find then with that the strengthening power of the Holy Ghost to be able to say, sin, I'm not going with you. I'm not spending eternity in a place called hell. I'm not going to taste of what looks like pleasure, because all it's going to end in is somebody's destruction, mine or somebody that I love. And I'm not opening the door to your death in hell. Yeah.
Amen.
I'm wise enough to realize that you bring with you the plague of death. You bring with you something far worse than the plague. You bring far with you something far worse than a disease that will kill you in 48 hours. Not having it. Not having it. Not having it, little man, are we? No, sir. Mm-mm. Hallelujah. We're not having it. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Praise the name of the Lord. Little Z. The little prophet, Ezekiel. Hallelujah. Prasa taramakiliasha. Hallelujah. I'm just so excited about him.
Hallelujah.
Thank you, Lord Jesus. And Naomi over here. And Anna, don't want to leave anybody out. And you. I don't leave anybody out. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. And of course, you can go on and read that. I mean, being filled, verse 29, being filled with all unrighteousness, fornication, wickedness, covetousness, maliciousness, full of envy, murder, debate, deceit, malignant whispers, backbiters. This is who the Lord's describing, that he gave over to a reprobate mind, that he gave over to vile affections. Sounds like a lot of people in the church. Hello. I'm going to tell you right now, somebody's going to have to get themselves a bloodline drawn in their line and recognize, wait a minute, Satan can't cross over that bloodline, and you better not cross over unto him.
Yeah.
And that all these things belonging to sin and iniquity is a testimony that you have nothing to do with the Holy Ghost. Nothing. And there's many people trapped in Christian religion as there are in Mormonism and any other ism. It's about time you get real with God. You lay hold on God so he can lay hold on you. Get serious with the proofs and stop trying to have somebody baby burp you all the time. Baby powder your pew because you was uncomfortable tonight. You need to lay hold on God.
Amen.
In the name of Jesus. Hallelujah. Amen. Praise the name of the Lord. Hakasi pratana maya. Hallelujah. Shepro nasaya. Somebody said, you better be careful. You might call some weak soul to question their salvation. What? Are you kidding me, man? What school did you go to? What planet did you come from? Give me a break. My goodness, God has called us to command everybody everywhere to repent and to train up the household of God how to walk in every way of righteousness, holiness, and purity. Give me a break. He's commanded us to speak with all power and authority to rebuke and to correct and to demand that God's way be executed, to cast out those and have no fellowship with those who go out at night and drink. I was telling the person the other day, I said, did you ever repent for trying to commit suicide? They said, no, I didn't know I needed to repent. How often do you get drunk? Oh, you know, they gave me that often. It was regular. Do you repent? You got drunk? Oh, didn't even think I needed to. What church had you been going to? And I'm not going to say what it was. Not yet. I'm awake. You're going to tell me that the gospel of the Lord Jesus Christ is being preached in those kinds of churches? That people don't even know to repent? I'm not just talking about just some lie or something. I talk bad about someone. I created strife. That's pretty gross stuff. Sounds like Romans chapter 1 to me. Backbiters, haters of God, despiteful, proud, boasters, inventors of evil things, disobedient to parents, without understanding, covenant breakers, without natural affection. They're just not even the natural compassion and consideration for human beings. Have you ever noticed that going down I-5? It's like, okay, go ahead, run me off the road. I mean, you know, just no compassion. There's no consideration. There's no concern. Implacable, unmerciful, who knowing the judgments of God, that they which commit such things are worthy of death, not only do the same, but they have pleasure in doing it. It is in that context that the spirit of strong delusion is in operation. That we all unrighteous, none of us are righteous, we all professional sinners. People from pulpits, not only here in Southern California, but all across America, all across the UK, all across Europe, speak those kind of nonsense. That's why my friends in China says, none of our people are coming to America. Why? Because by and large, they look at the church here in America as being apostate. We're not allowing any of our people to come over there. They're going to be ruined. They're going to think that you people are showing them the right way of God. We will not allow any of them. I said, I promise you, I'll keep them out in the woods. They won't go near anywhere. They said, we're not taking the risk. Our responsibility is the sheep, and we're not allowing them to go to America to be involved in any measure with any American church. Can you hear me? Because
yes.
I'm not listening to people. Hello.
Yes.
We can sit around and self-justify and say, oh, well, it isn't so. It's not really that bad. You're an extremist. You always take the most radical point to the extreme position. It's valid. God's a radical person.
Yes. Amen.
And every point that he's making is extreme. It's a matter of life or death.
Yes.
Amen. It's all a matter of life or death. That's it. You can't get any more extreme. I want you to go quickly with me. I know I didn't finish 2 Thessalonians, did I? Verse 12 of 2 Thessalonians chapter 2, that they all might be damned. Hear that? Strong delusion came to them. Antichrist spirit. in the midst of signs and wonders and miracles. But it wasn't signs and wonders and miracles that worked a resolve to holiness and commitment to truth and righteousness and godliness and purity. Mm-hmm. It was signs and wonders and miracles that confirmed their iniquity, right, that gave them an excuse to continue on in their sin, mm-hmm, that did not result in a holy fear and an encounter with a holy God. It resulted in a fascination, in a thrill, in something that was purely superficial, and they called it the glory. And they walked around like a bunch of freaked out flakes in a mental institution picking up jewels off the carpet. And there ain't no jewel there. They're hallucinating. It was a piece of dirt from my shoe. That was the normal everyday rock from that goes out on that ranch, naturally. It came out of the back end of a cow. It's true. It's total insanity. It's verifiable insanity. It's Satan mocking God's holy church. It's Satan mocking the anointing, invalidating everything that Jesus did at Calvary's cross. False witnesses. Provable, because the fruits of God's word, the fruits of God's life are not present. And it's wickedness from the head all the way to the foot. When I say head, I'm talking about leadership. He says that they might be damned who believe not the truth but have pleasure in unrighteousness. I ask you, do you have pleasure in unrighteousness? I'll ask you, do you have pleasure in unrighteousness? You in a wrong category. Do you enjoy sin and iniquity? You have no fear of God, you in a wrong category. I'm going to tell you right now, you're going to burn. Because you chose to follow demons. You chose to follow the powers of darkness. You chose to give your holy members over unto unrighteousness so that every vile thing could be worked in your body by a demon spirit to mock God through you. And too many of you would say, oh yeah, I'm a Christian. This is what it's like to be saved. Verse 13, Paul said, but we are bound to give thanks always to God for you, brethren, beloved of the Lord, because God hath from the beginning chosen you to salvation through sanctification of the Spirit and belief unto the truth. Wherefore, whereunto he calls you by the gospel to the obtaining of glory of our Lord Jesus Christ. So he makes a clear distinction between the brethren, and he goes on to make a clear distinction between the brethren who are responding to the truth, who are the body of the Lord Jesus Christ, who are set apart, separated unto the very living God, living and existing in the Holy Ghost, from these other folks. Quickly, go with me to Jude. I'm going to try to do this quickly. Go with me to Jude. Jude opens up and he starts, it's almost like, hey guys, I was busy doing something else, but suddenly I was moved by God and I grabbed a hold of my pen with great urgency to write this message to you. This is how Jude sets this up. Are you with me? And so I'm just going to read it to you because that's the feel. It's, you know, not only in the Greek language, but also here in the English language. Jude, the slave of Jesus Christ, under the control of Jesus Christ. Huh? Under the rulership of Jesus Christ. Because we've called him Lord too long. We don't even know what Lord is anymore. Now we need to just understand what Lord is. That's ruler. The one who has absolute authority over me. Huh? Brother of James, to them that are sanctified, that means consecrated to God, in God, by God. Hallelujah. That means you live in the holies of holies. Hello. That means you live right in the sanctuary of his divine glory and power and presence. Where the seraphims cover their face. Okay? Mercy unto you. And peace and love be multiplied. Beloved, when I gave all diligence to write unto you concerning the common salvation, it was needful for me to write unto you and exhort you that you should earnestly contend for the faith which was once delivered unto the saints. This is what God is doing, and it's a movement, and it's actually happening right now, and I'm a part of it, where ministers and preachers are coming together from all different parts of the earth saying, understanding who we are and what company we are of. We are the company of those who are contending for the faith that was once delivered unto saints. We do not want to go with some new revelation, some new doctrine, some new idea, because all it is heresy. God's book is closed. I mean, I'm telling you right now, it's so closed that the final word is spoken. His name is Jesus. Yes. And Jesus himself, the word, only quoted the word, that's showing right to us very clearly to speak the word only.
Speak the word only.
And he brought to us one new revelation, and he said one new commandment, and that's it. And that one new commandment was that we now are to love one another with the same love that the Father loved him, so that we get to now, he's commanded us not to just love our neighbor as ourselves, not just in a human realm, but he's commanded us because he's empowered us now to love with the same love that God himself possesses. And that is supernatural and powerful and wonderful, and I want that. You can have the rest. Huh? And I pray that you say with me, I want that, and everybody else can have the rest. If you want hell, have at it. I'll take heaven. You want Satan, have at it. I'll take God. You want death, have at it. I'll take life. You want a lie, have at it. I'll take truth. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Praise the name of Jesus. God's good. So listen to what he says, because he's going to talk about strong delusion. He's going to talk about what's going on, why he's emphasizing contending for the faith that was once delivered unto saints. He's going to emphasize people who come with supernatural signs and wonders, but they're from the realms of darkness, not from God. But they're saying they are from God. So he begins to take it on. For he says this. He says, for there are certain men crept in unaware. They crawled in here. They slithered in here. Who were before of old ordained to this condemnation. Radical concept. Ordained to this condemnation. For of old they were ordained to this condemnation. In other words, their deeds and their behaviors and what they've given themselves over was already ordained into condemnation. He doesn't say they personally were. He said what they're participating with, their behavior, what they bought into, was already ordained into condemnation to be destroyed. Okay? He said, or these ungodly men turning the grace of God into lasciviousness. One of the first earmarks of someone who's come with a spirit of strong delusion, a spirit of deception, no matter what they're doing, no matter what they're saying. And many times it's in the context, always, not well, many times it's in the context of lying signs and wonders, lying miracles. It is always a spirit of strong delusion. It's always a deceiving spirit at work to try to lead God's people into error. The only defense is God's word. His word is a lamp unto our feet and a light unto our path. His word is a defense. His word abides in me so that I don't sin. Even in the Old Testament, thy word have I hid in my heart that I sin not. In the New Testament, I write unto young men because you're strong. The word of God abides in you and you've conquered Satan at every point. It's the word of God. It's holding tight to the word of God. There is no, it is not even possible to overthrow the word of God. Hell and earth can be overthrown, but not one word of God. Hold on to the word of God. All flesh is grass. All the glory of men as the flower of the field. It withers. It comes to an end. But they who do the word of God abides forever.
Amen.
The word unchanging.
Yeah.
Imperishable.
Yes. Hallelujah.
Grab a hold of it.
Yes.
And that's what the Holy Ghost is going to be doing.
Amen.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah. And nobody's going to really live the word. If you're speaking against the Holy Ghost, you foul-mouthed thing. I'm talking to the web again. Somebody's watching the web that Father doesn't like. Father's against you. He'll fight against you with the sword of his mouth. Your days are numbered. I have more to say, but I'm going to get back to this. First key, they turn the grace of God into lasciviousness. They say, let us continue in sin that grace may abound. Rasputin literally means defiled, debauchery. Rasputin, we call him the mad monk. He was the guy who said, what I'm going to do is I'm going to give myself over to all immorality that I might enjoy the extreme pleasures of God's grace. And Rasputin began to work signs and wonders and miracles. He's just one of many. I'll just pick him tonight. Because Rasputin was used by the devil to, by and large, overthrow the normalcy, though there was wickedness under what was the ancient Mother Russia, under the Tsars of Russia. But yet at that time, they carried the torch for the gospel. Hello? They did. Russia, under the Tsars, carried the torch of the gospel throughout the world. But Rasputin comes along and does lying signs and wonders. Huh? It's true. And he gets credit for the child that was born as a hemophiliac for being cured when the doctors couldn't stop bleeding. Now he has the ear of the nobility, and through his advice and his counsel, all he did was make the situation worse and could be, in some respects, regarded as the one who caused the Bolshevik Revolution, the overthrow of a civil Russian government that had at its helm a mandate to take the gospel to the nations, that in very short order became a communist country in which his name was not even allowed to be spoken. And Rasputin, the mad monk, who had given himself over to all lasciviousness that he might enjoy the full pleasures of grace. This isn't something that just happened one time. It's history is littered with it. It's trash. Yeah. And it's a remarkable thing that they all did signs and wonders. They all did miracles, verifiable miracles. Once again, it's Satan now being allowed by God because of the behavior of the people. I mean, the church was messed up in Russia at this point. Their revival was basically at an end. There was great holiness, a great move of God, of healing and legitimate signs and wonders, a great moving of God in Russia that affected the nations of the earth. Great prophets raised up in Russia in the 1800s. Great move of God. But by the time these events happen, now the church is lukewarm. It's just basically stale and cold, and the preachers are arguing between themselves over what type of vestments to wear, what kind of suits to wear, what kind of suits bless God, and what kind of suits offend God. It's just big war. And in the midst of that, God is completely kicked out of a nation. But he's the one who allowed the strong delusion to come. He sent them strong delusion. He gave them over to a reprobate mind. He gave them over to their vile affections. Are you listening to me?
Yes.
He gave them over to their gods that they wanted to worship, to be destroyed by them. Talking about Israel now, the northern kingdom, also the southern kingdom. So important to watch out. Those who take the grace of God and turn it into lasciviousness and say the grace that allows us then the privilege to do what's wrong, and we're still seen positionally as right before God. That's a doctrine not of men. It's a doctrine born out of hell by Satan himself. He came up with that one. He didn't leave that one to some lower demons or some lower angel. He himself decided that one, and he has hooked so many people with it. It's the first earmark that there is a spirit of strong delusion, and Satan is in the midst of it. As soon as you're around people and you start hearing them try to give you an excuse for sin and iniquity and try to bring you into it, recognize that you are dealing with someone who is under a power of deception. With all meekness, present the love of God, present the word of God, try to turn them from their pernicious ways, from their peditious ways. Important. We're contending for the faith that was once delivered unto the saints, and what we've got to deal with is we've got to deal with these who slithered in here, these who crept in unaware, these who have given themselves over to that which was damned long ago because of Satan's self-exaltation when he tried himself to overthrow God and wanted to be God and be worshipped as God. It's all this context. You understand what I'm saying? I don't want you to lose the context of the realm in which this darkness came from, because one day it will come to an end. It's last battle and it's last stand, and everybody who wants to follow Satan. And it is no wonder to me that people say the things they wanted to say about denying God and wanting Satan and trying to say that, you know, somehow God doesn't exist. Because after living in the millennial reign with Christ Jesus, with resurrected saints, with angels all around, with all the glory and pristine power of God being manifest for 1,000 years, Satan is loosed for a little season, and all people from all over the earth flock unto him in at the number of the sands of the, on the seashores for number. Can you imagine? That is where men's hearts are at. And it's not going to be in me. No. And I'm going to point it out when I see it.
Right.
I'm going to declare it where I see it. For two reasons. One, first and foremost, so that the person I'm talking to can see it. And second of all, so everybody knows where I stand concerning their witness.
Yeah.
You can come over here and you can walk with God in this holy place. You can come over here and walk with God in this heavenly place. You can come over here and walk in the Holy Ghost. Walk in the Spirit of truth. You have a right and a privilege. God has invited all men everywhere, no matter how wicked they are, to come through the door, to come on in, and to be miraculously transformed, to be holy and acceptable unto Him, to be as He is, to live in Him and He live in us. But not all men will choose these things. And they are just candidates for Satan to work his lying wonders and his deception through. And if there's one thing, I was telling Debbie this the other day, I was telling other preachers this, the one thing we got to do, forget about everything, about everybody feeling good, everybody feeling the glory. Forget about it. Right now, we got so many deceivers running around, everybody getting joy and feeling the glory and having all this stuff. Forget about it. I know people need to preach the word. The plumb line needs to be set up. The line needs to be drawn. People need to hear the word. They need to understand the difference between right and wrong, good and evil, truth and lying, God and Satan. There needs to be a division between that which is holy and that which is profane. People need to understand these things I'm telling you right now. And I want you to be filled with the grace of it. And in the midst of it, Father's going to do signs and wonders and miracles. But I'm not going to be identified with the liars and the deceivers. Debbie was telling me she was in a meeting just recently, and some real popular person came in, and she said, as he was going to minister one night, she didn't know him, she was just like, she was one of the guest ministers. She said it was the most vile display of demon power she's ever seen, and this is a popular person who the youth is flocking to all over the place, and there's a crew of them. I'm not going to be identified with them. They're going to know my signs and wonders are different from theirs. The glory you feel in this place is different from that. And hear the word. You've got sin in your life. You're not right with God. It's the power of hell that has hold on you. You're going out and you're involved in all this stuff. It's proof that you're under the spirit of strong delusion. You believed a lie so that you could be damned. And now all you're doing is being used by Satan to draw as many people as you possibly can out of the truth, away from God. Those who could clean escape from damnation, now all you've done is entangled them again. And now they're worse off than what they were before. It's the battlefront right now. It's it. And Father's going to come with His glory, and He's going to do some majestic stuff in the middle of this big mess, and you watch, because He is earnest about showing a distinction between that which He's chosen and that which He's not chosen, between the holy and the profane, between His shepherds and false prophets. And He's going to.
Thank you, Father.
Watch. You just want to be on the right side when it comes down, because it's going to be heavy.
Right.
Huh?
Yeah.
You're going to need some joy for this. I promise you. They also, and denying the only Lord God and our Lord Jesus Christ. And, you know, really, that is the ultimate state of it. And recently, there is a pretty famous guy in ministry who is doing all kinds of seemingly extraordinary miracles, and he was found out that he didn't really believe in Jesus. He had a really different definition of Jesus. it ultimately came to that. And he was right here in California, and he's still right here in California, up in Northern California. And he had didn't really believe in the only true God. He had a different definition of him. And about the only way that it could be brought down is that he was New Age. Well, it was worse than that. It's called sorcery. Provable sorcery. And, you know, I know some people that are very closely involved with situations, so hear me. And a lot of people are carried away with it, deceived by it. I wasn't. You know why? Because I'm going to make everybody go through the test of the word. And if their life isn't lining up with the word of God, I'm saying you're wrong.
Right. Amen.
And it's not being someone who's narrow-minded, and I'm not being someone who's puffed up with knowledge because love edifies. No, I'm saying, wait a minute, there is a place where you begin to speak stuff. There's things that aren't that, you know, drastic, but there's a place where there's a line that you cross. And when you begin to allow certain things, when you begin to give excuses for sin, especially that, is one of the big earmarks, then it's already proven. You're going to miss it. There was a time in my life where I believe there was just no way I can tell you whether it was the anointing or not. And then the Lord allowed me to be in a situation where I was in a particular event, meeting, Ann and I were, and in every dimension, we thought it was the anointing, the glory of God, the same effect. It was demonic, and the Lord showed us demonic. And then later on, the Lord made it very clear to me. He said, you knew it was. You just didn't recognize it. And I'm just having this dialogue with the Lord because it was the word of God that discerned the situation. It was only the word of God that truly discerned the situation, because things were said and things that were done that were clearly, this is clearly crossing over the line. But I excused it and let it go under the pretense of endeavoring to keep the unity of the spirit and the bond of peace and just show love and be merciful, not, you know, edify, not be. And the Lord said, no. You stick with the word. And now as we approach even a greater apostasy, and as we approach a day of deception, because bottom line, people, I don't care what you believe, the reality of it is the scripture says that we're going to come to a place where the whole world is going to follow after an antichrist spirit. We read of a great falling away, of the great apostasy during the days of the wrath of God, which we call the tribulation, and we are headed to that point, and we're somewhere on that way, and we're far much closer to it now than the early church was when the scriptures were being written. And so between this point right now and that point, which I don't know how far out in the future it is, it's going to increasingly get worse. Things are going to get darker and darker. The apostate church is going and seducing spirits and doctrines of devils and itching ears are going to get worse. We're going to have to hold tight and firm to those things which were once delivered unto the saints and fight for it, because that's what contend means.
Amen.
Just hang with me. Just hang with me. Try to hang with me here. I know he's cute. He's a major distraction. He says, verse 5, I will therefore put you in remembrance, though you once knew this, how that the Lord, having saved the people out of the land of Egypt, afterwards destroyed them that believed not. You need to hear this. Yes. What is the Lord saying? He says, listen, guys, I had, just like you, there were others that were in the same in a covenant with me. But they were not willing to obey me. They were not willing to walk under my direction and listen to the servants and leaders that I raised up. Reality of it is, I'm expanding on this, they fathered others like Korah and Dathan and other ministers that were liars, who were speaking their own way, speaking the things that was coming out of the realm of the demonic, and ultimately resulted in those things that we read about in the Old Testament of where God himself had to destroy them. I mean, this should cause everybody to listen up. Jude's underscoring by the Holy Spirit that just because in the covenant, just because God showed his mercy upon you, doesn't mean that somehow you've got it made from here on in. Because if you don't listen, if you disobey, if you get carried away by the deceivers, you're going to end up being destroyed just as they were destroyed. I mean, Hebrews chapter 3 and Hebrews chapter 4 is also just devoted to the same subject. He says this. He says, and the angels, which kept not their first estate. Listen, if I'm going to bring this down on angels, then why do you believe I'm not going to bring it down on you? If I'm going to hold the angels responsible, how do you think that somehow I'm not going to hold you responsible? If the angels are going to sin and they're going to result in a judgment falling upon their head, then if you sin, a judgment's going to fall on your head too. That's what he's saying. He said, the angels which kept not their first estate, but left their own habitation, he has reserved an everlasting change under darkness, under judgment of the great day. Even Sodom and Gomorrah. And he's given us these examples, and he's giving us these types, and he's laying it out for us and saying, guys, listen to me. Anybody that's going to tell you can somehow have other kinds of lifestyles, that somehow after you've been born again, after you've been made a new creation, after you've come in this relationship with God, that you can continue on living in some other form of hell, some other form of sin and iniquity, they liars. Because I'm going to tell you, just like this, just like Israel was destroyed by me, just like angels were destroyed or judged by me, just like Sodom and Gomorrah were destroyed by me, he's saying, you're going to be destroyed too. We'll read on. Let's let you see it. Even as Sodom and Gomorrah and the cities round about them, in like manner, gave himself over to fornication and going after strange flesh, bestialities, and all kinds of iniquity, strange flesh. And are set forth an example to who? You and me. Suffering vengeance of eternal fire, not just a temporal fire. They didn't just have fire come down out of heaven and consume them right there. They had fire come out of heaven, consume them right there, and then they immediately ended up in a flame that is an eternal fire. People say there's not enough information on hell. People, I got loads of information on hell. We've got specific definition on hell. It's so real, Jesus said, if your eye offends you, pluck it out. It's better for you to enter into the kingdom of God having one eye than to be cast into hell having two eyes. Yeah. Come on, people. Yeah. The list goes on. Yeah. If I wrote a book on the realities of hell, no one would publish it. It'd have to be self-published. And you know, and the marketing of the Christian community would never take it up, so it probably wouldn't be read. Because hell don't sell. Telling people that they're going to go to hell don't sell. And one very popular editor and publisher told a friend of mine that says, and repentance doesn't sell either. Nobody wants to buy a book to tell them to repent. No, this is true. I'm diluting it. I'm not making it worse than it was. And this is the state. This is our leaders. Likewise, also these filthy dreamers defile the flesh, despise dominion, speak evil of dignities. Don't need to go to church. Just same having church in your living room. Don't need to listen to all these gray-haired people. Oh, they just a bunch of religious people anyways. They've never really known the freedom of the power of the Holy Ghost. No, we've never known the freedom of that demon spirit you're possessed by. And don't want to. And the popularity of that voice is so loud right now. And it is influencing so many people that have seemingly responded to Jesus but are entangled by the snare of deception and the delusion happening right now. And we crying out to God. We contending. I'm not just telling you this to run things down and make things look bad. I'm telling you this first of all so that you can be guarded against it, so that you can be that much more resolved to holding tight to the Word of God and the proofs of the Word of God, and so that you can also begin to pray and intercede for a fiery display of God's holiness and conviction and judgment in this nation. You know, somebody said, who are you voting for? I said, I'm voting for the person that is going to bring the nation to its knees the fastest because of chaos, upheaval, and judgment. And behold, and hang on. Strap in your safety belt. Amen. And I feel sorry for all the ministers and all the people that put their trust in the arm of flesh, because God said they're going to be cursed. The government's got its job to do, and the church got its job to do. And I'm going to tell you right now, the government doesn't have the lead. The church does. Amen. That's just the way it is.
Amen.
Yet Michael the archangel, when he contended with the devil, he disputed about the body of Moses, did not bring against them a railing accusation, but said, "The Lord rebuke you. But these speak evil of those things which they know not, but what they know naturally as brute beasts, and those things they corrupt themselves. Woe unto them, for they have gone in the way of Cain." What is that? What's the way of Cain? Listen, I've offered my sacrifice the way I believe it's supposed to be done. This is the offering that I think should be presented by God. And God, you accept it. And if you don't accept it, too bad. And if I see a righteous someone who's righteous and walking in purity and holiness, being accepted by God, I'm going to do everything I can possibly do to kill him. Because, in fact, that latter part is the emphasis that John places on it in first epistle of John. He said Cain was of that wicked one and slew his brother. Why did he slay his brother? Because his brother's deeds were righteous and his were unrighteous. And so people are going to run down the anointing. They're going to say, it's a new thing. It's just, the way that it's, suppose they could just write everybody off. Oh, they just religious. Now, you know what? I used to wear t-shirt, jeans, and flip-flops. And all these other people came along, so I put on a suit. Because they came along saying, this is what you got to do to be, if you're going to really, relate to people from God. I'm like, you got to be kidding me. Give me a suit. I don't want to be in the number. I put the suit on. Are you listening to me? People, come on now. I wanted you to be guarded against this mess. I don't want you to listen to their music. Their music is a trance. Their music is a trance. Their music sounds like praise. It's like a prophet of God told a dear friend of mine. He said he'd been casting out devils and he went into a vision after the meeting was over, and Satan was outside of his room where he was, banging on the window saying, I'm going to come in there and I'm going to tear you up. I'm going to beat you up. I'm going to thrash you, screaming from outside the window. And he came in and he put up his fist like he was a boxer. And then he said, "Wow, you're really amazing guy. I'm really impressed with you and your resolve towards God." Just started flattering him. And he said, "You want to know how I deceived the angels?" And he folded himself into a big accordion. And the prophet of God said, he began to play the most beautiful music he'd ever heard. It was the most beautiful worship. It carried with it the most amazing sense of the presence of God that he had ever felt. And it was verse after verse and course after course of the high praises of God. He was just taken with it. He was taken with it. As Satan is showing him how he deceived the angels. And he goes on praising God and declaring the wonders of God and the glory of God and the majesty of God with verse after verse and course after course. And then he finally said at the very end, "And worship me too." And that was it. And so we see how that same thing happens in the music that people are doing right now, today. And people are being fascinated to say they feel the anointing. Do you even know what the anointing is? Do you know that the anointing brings a convincing, shaking, trembling, awesome conviction of the holiness of God to where that you're so under the presence of His holiness that you just, every sin you've ever committed flashes through your head and you come under this great resolve never to do it again, to walk in His purity because you behold that which is glorious and wonderful. That's the anointing. People have got a wrong definition of the anointing. They feel like they feel good. I feel good. This is better than any drug I've ever done. Where's the flag so I can wave it? Certifiable insanity. It is just not, no, there's nothing majestic about it. The great revivals of God were full of majesty and glory and awe and wonder, and it caused men to fall before His presence, confessing their sins, screaming out, "Oh God, have mercy upon me." That's the earmark of revival. And suddenly it's changed in the 20th century, in the 21st century. No, it hasn't. And the proof is there was holiness there. There's unholiness here. There was purity there. There's impurity there. Here, there was a consecration, a submission, an honor to the anointing there. There's a dishonor here. Hello, you better wake up.
Yes.
Better wake up. Stop sleeping in the light. You think God's judgments has changed? It's not. A day is as 1,000 years to him. 1,000 years is a day. He's not, it's just, there's no difference between how he was 1,000 years ago or 10,000 years ago, because it's just, it's all in the same span of time, as it were. Or even 100,000 years ago. He's the same God of the Old Testament as he is in the New Testament. All has happened today is he's made a way for you and I to be one with him, to be holy and acceptable unto him, to live in his glory and his majesty, be empowered with everything that belongs to him. And you better get real with it. 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 You better quit cheating on God. You better quit playing games with God and acting like he understands your stubbornness, your rebellion, your backsliding, because he doesn't. He's just merciful. That's all. I don't understand it. He's merciful. But it's time to get real. People better get real. There's got to be some kind of witness of people being real. I'm going to be real. I'm going to be more radical. I'm committed to being more radical. Tonight I commit to be more radical in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ than I've ever been in my entire life. Woe unto them. They've gone in the way of Cain. They greedily run after the heir of Balaam. What was the heir of Balaam? He's a prophet. He's prophesying. But what he wants is he'll do anything for some money. He'll compromise for the money. He'll compromise for the reward. There's greed involved. Godliness is gain. Making merchandise of the people of God. This one ministry that I was talking about where these men of God said, out of this will come forth the greatest blasphemy of the Holy Ghost. Geneva has a dream. She sees in this ministry, this is many, many years ago, she sees right after, this is a witness to it, she sees people going in, lining up, going into the meeting, and the people on the platform was feeding them hamburgers. Well, what was happening in the back room is that the people that were in the previous meeting were being ground in the hamburger, so that the men of God were supposedly men of God were feeding them the flesh. Feeding them flesh. Things of flesh. Pure humanity. The abominable things. It wasn't long after that I found out that, you know, they were having shots of vodka and smoking cigars, and that's what they did to hang out in the green room after the meeting. And then it advanced from there. Yeah, they weren't drunk in the Holy Ghost, folks. It was pure vodka from Russia, the best label, which your offering dollars paid for. And the list goes on. It's time to wake up.
Amen.
You know, it's time to quit being so stinking gullible when we've got so much wisdom and insight. The gullibility of people. I just recently typed on Google. You know, on Google right now, there's this big new thing. It's a new conspiracy. Actually, did you know that the earth is actually flat right now? It's a conspiracy. Yeah, it's flat. No one's ever circumnavigated the globe. There was never anybody landing on the moon. There's never been a spacecraft going out into the atmosphere. I don't know what the satellites are. I didn't get an explanation on that. The people by the droves are believing it. Just gullible, one thing after. Just stinking gullible. People start telling me about the FDA and start telling me about clinical science. That's my world. As though everybody's bought into some lie that there's a cure for cancer, and now there's a payoff of millions of dedicated and ethical scientists. Is that ever the silliest thing you've ever heard? You would have to pay off so many credible scientists just right over here at the Salk Institute. Give me a break. These people have devoted their life to the cure for cancer because they've had loved ones die. If there was even any indication, people. It's nonsense. Gullible, 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 gullible. Listening to a bunch of lies. There's no end to it. Let's just grab a hold of the word and start having a strong defense. I mean, I can invalidate all of this gullible, nonsense, conspiracy theory is silly from the core. Newsflash, Satan is the prince of the power of the air. The god of this world. Okay. Now, setting that aside, give me a break. Let's just hunker down in the Word of God and make it be proven. Amen. And if it's not proven in the Word of God, if it doesn't look like Jesus, I don't want it.
Amen. Right.
If it doesn't look like holiness and purity and sanctification, I don't want it.
Amen.
Right.
If it doesn't look like walking in the Spirit, I'm not interested.
Amen.
I don't care who they are. They can be the king of the world. I'm not listening to them.
Yeah. Amen.
Paul said, if an angel comes and preaches any of the Gospels, just let them be accursed. Don't have anything to do with it.
Right.
I honor people. I honor men that are anointed of God, but I'm not following them outside the Word. I didn't tell them, listen, I love you and I honor you, but I totally disagree with you. You take that road, you're not going to find me following you. You just stay with where you're supposed to be. You follow Jesus, and you'll find me right there with you. I'm in the company. I'm going to be in the company of those who are contending for the faith. Yes. Once delivered unto the saints. That's it. I'm not going to get myself involved in the leaven of the Pharisees, nor in the leaven of the Herodians, which is politics. I'm not going to get involved in either one of them. Politics has to listen to me, and the Pharisees have to listen to me. Pharisees have nothing for me, neither does governmental powers. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
But that's what Jesus said. I'm just to do what Jesus said. That's what Jesus said. I'm going to leave that stuff alone. I'm gonna get down on my knees. We'll settle it on our knees. We're going to prophesy. We'll see a nation change and the politics of a nation change because we go there, we're sent by God, and we prophesy the nation, just like in Nepal, just like it's happening in Kashmir, just like what's happening in Cuba right now.
Yeah.
And we'll be back in January. So we're going to do it in America the same way. And that's how America began. It began that way, and it's going to be sustained that way. I'm not going to do it any other way. People want to try to tell me and convince me of something else, I'm not listening. Talk to the hand. They went after the reward of Balaam. They perished in the gainsaying of Korah. What is that? What is perishing in the gainsaying of Korah? Korah's going, aren't we anointed too? Moses, he's not the only one that knows God. What does he think he is? Who does he think he's so special that somehow, you know, all the rest of us, we got bigger ministries, we got more money, we're more, you know, this and that and the other thing. Follow us. You know what happened to Korah?
Yeah.
Moses said, well, I'll tell you what. Don't want to deny your opportunity to minister before the Lord. Go get your censer and let's go stand in front of the Father and see who he chooses. Suddenly, everybody got a witness that not the person that looked the most majestic and the most dignified and the most glorified was the one that Father was honoring. It was the one that did his word. Always you're going to see from Matthew chapter 7 verse 21 to 1 John chapter 2 verse 17, it's those who do the will of the Father that come into the kingdom that endure forever. The world and lust thereof pass away, but they that do the will of the Father abide forever. The will of the Father, those who live in the Word of God. The Word of God describes the will of the Father, who do His Word. Not everyone is justified. The hearers are not justified, but they who do His Word. That's what He says. So we're not compromising it. So he says this, these are spots in your feast of charity. These are when they feast with you, feeding themselves without fear. Look at this. They're clouds without water, carried about with the wind. Trees whose fruit withers, without fruit. They're without fruit. They're so without fruit. They're so without the meekness, lowliness, humility, brokenness, purity, holiness, righteousness, long-suffering, patience, and meekness that they twice plucked up. I mean, you can't be, you're just twice dead. They twice plucked up, twice dead, plucked up by the roots, raging waves of the sea. Foaming out their own shame, wondering stars to whom is reserved the blackness of darkness forever. There's a lot of symbolism here that I'm hesitating going into because I've already gone a long time. And to begin to flesh this out for you, to help you understand what the symbolism is referring to, would take me a little bit more time than I think that you're going to give me here. And most of you have been in meetings all week, or most of the week. But I challenge you to just go and look at the symbolism and understand what's being referred to here. And understand the demonic power that is symbolized. And what that demonic power was able to do in terms of things that had to do with lying signs and wonders that deceived people, that was able to do things that look like what you would see in sorcery, what you would see in magic. Just have Jesus' name on it. Just have something. Satan knows everything about the anointing. He has the power to display it. And then, you know, if you look in, I don't want to go to Revelation chapter 16, because I know I get stuck there. But you see that these unclean spirits are able to go out of the mouth of the false prophet.
Yeah.
And the same kind of thing happens now. It's not at the same extent. It's not the same. That's going to be an unlimited display of the power of Satan and wickedness. But now, the same things are going on. It just, there's a restraint placed on it. Those unclean spirits go out of the mouth of the false prophet. And they gather the nations into a place of deception. And once again, there's the working of signs and wonders. I mean, display of power to where that the image that is built for the beast can not only is living, it breathes, it talks. That's pretty powerful stuff. Calls fire down out of heaven. It looks like it's coming from God. And uses God's name probably to do, I don't know. You know, they may just, the Antichrist or the false prophet may just do it in the name of the Antichrist, or may just do it in the name of Satan, because he's making himself look like God. But it's coming down out of heaven. It looks like he has all the authority to deceive the nations with it. He says, Enoch, also the seventh from Adam, prophesied. And here's the point. He says to them, the Lord's coming with 10,000s of his saints to execute judgment upon all the ungodly for the ungodly deeds which they've ungodly committed. Is there any ungodliness in your life? Because if there is, you're going to be involved in the number of the ungodly, because this is who God's wrath is directed towards. The grace of God that brings salvation has appeared to every man and teaches us to deny ungodliness and worldly lust and to live righteously and godly right now in this present world. And if you don't get that, you don't get God. If you can't hear that, it's because you're not his sheep. If you don't respond to what he has called us to do, it's because you've not been in power with the Holy Ghost, or maybe you were one time in power with the Holy Ghost, but you've rejected him, because Father and the Holy Ghost that has come to live on the inside of us is enough authority and enough power to say no to every sin and iniquity. So you better grab a hold of God until you got some proof that you really know him. Amen. Instead of just some verbal declaration of it, because that means nothing. God says, let me see the deeds of it. He tells me to make sure the deeds are there. He says, don't believe it. If the fruit's not there, don't believe it. He says, because no good tree can bring forth evil fruit, and no evil tree can bring forth good fruit. He says, no bitter fountain can bring forth sweet water, and no sweet fountain will bring forth bitter water. Either make the tree good and its fruit good, or make the tree evil and its fruit evil. Yeah. Either make the fountain sweet and its water sweet, or make the fountain bitter and its water bitter. And we want people to condone us when we've got evil fruit and call us a good tree. No, not going to do it. I'm going to tell you the truth. Perhaps you might repent and turn to the Lord. This is what it's all about. He's bringing it down again. You're not going to walk in sin. He's also all about contending for the faith that was once delivered under the saints, and recognizing that there is the deceivers that have gone out that turned the grace of God into a license to sin, or turned the grace of God into the privilege of committing lasciviousness. Did you know that Israel started worshiping God through in the midst of orgies and having relationship with prostitutes? And that was the whole idolatry, and that's why God gave them over to the gods that they worship. And it was always at the core of every wicked thing that Satan did against God to defile his people, was always about sexual immorality. It was at the heart of it, I said, over and again. And so all the way through this, he's given us examples of, listen, do you think that you're going to escape the damnation of hell if you walk in the same ungodliness? Do you think that you're going to escape the just damnation of an eternity without God if you're unwilling to obey the truth and hearken to the truth. And that's what this is, the warning's going out. And it's time, people, that you and I begin to give ourselves every day to the presence of God and to Holy Ghost conviction. Because if we don't give ourselves to Holy Ghost conviction, to walking in a place of obedience to God, there will never be conviction in the earth again. Until the people of God will move in Holy Ghost conviction and not allow the sin and the iniquity, because they'll respond to the gentle tuggings and conviction of the Holy Ghost that says, no, don't do that, don't partake of that. And we've been fortified in God's word and by his spirit, say, no, I'm not going to be involved in any form of sin or evil or iniquity.
Amen. Right.
I'm not going to listen to people who say, ah, you're a liar if you say you don't sin. Because they the liar. They wrestle the scripture to their own destruction. Somebody just try to tell me I've got to believe that I'm unrighteous. That's anti-Christ, anti-word, anti-God. Because I believed unto righteousness with the heart. And I've been made the righteousness of God in him. And everyone that does righteousness is righteous, even as he is righteous. And he that sins is of the devil. And that's just all there is. And we know that if we've been born of God, we don't sin, we keep ourselves. And the wicked one can't touch us. And the list goes on and on. And we're going to stay right there. We're not going to listen to people's philosophy and ideology that they've inherited from Christian traditions. These are murmurers. Uh-oh. That's why God overthrew Israel in the wilderness. They murmured against him. They murmured against the anointed ones. The anointed, the leader. Murmurers. Complainers. Always, I want you to know, this is primarily in the context of how you feel about the pastor. How you feel about the leader, how you feel about the preacher, how you feel about a sermon that went right to the heart of your situation and pained you. Because no one wants anybody to tell them that they wrong. My job is to tell you where you're wrong. Hallelujah.
Amen.
Nobody wants to come to church and give in the offering to hear that they need to repent. It's just it's the spirit, the atmosphere of the church. No one wants to pay to hear that they need to repent. They want you to tell them that they're okay when they're not. Then you're partaker of their sin. When you tell them that they're okay when they're not, you partake of their sin. So their same sin's on you now. That's what God says. Murmurers, complainers, walking after their own lust. Their mouths speak great swelling words. Having men's person in admiration because of advantage. There's a lot to say there, and they go so many different directions. But, beloved, remember ye the words spoken to us by the apostles of our Lord Jesus Christ, how that they told you that there should be mockers in the last days who should walk after their own ungodly lust. Mockers. They say they're servants of God. They're mocking the redemption. Yeah. They're mocking the holiness of God. Mm-hmm. They're saying they're the temple of God and they're the temple of devils. They're the house of Belial. These be they who separate themselves sensual, having not the Spirit. But ye, beloved, build up yourself in your most holy faith, praying in the Holy Ghost. Keep yourself in the love of God, looking for the mercy of our Lord Jesus Christ unto eternal life. And if some have compassion, making a difference. Yes, sir. And others save with fear, pulling them out of the fire because they're already burning and they don't know it. Yes, sir. Hating even the garment spotted with the flesh. Just being so totally anti-sin and anti-devil and anti-demon spirits. You hate even a little spot.
Amen.
In the midst of the company of the church.
Yes.
Now unto him who is able to keep us from stumbling. Hallelujah. Now unto him. This is a very wonderful and encouraging verse of scripture in the midst of all of that stuff. Now unto him who's able to keep us from falling. And understanding this, when you look at Peter, because Peter is basically taking up this same message in 2 Peter, and he's saying, you know, we have everything that we need. God's given us everything we need according to his divine power. We have it all. We have all the ability of life and godliness because he called us to glory and purity because he's made us partakers of his divine nature. And now we must give all diligence to making our calling and election sure by giving, adding to our faith purity. And we're walking around saying, I'm walking in purity. Yeah. There's nothing so wonderful as purity. It gives you 20/20 vision in the spirit. Yeah. You're not, I mean, I'm telling you right now, it gives you great confidence and boldness towards God. You're able to see and understand what's going on in the realms of heaven. You're not all muddled with sin and compromise and treason. Amen. But unto him who is able to keep us from falling and stumbling, really, and present us faultless before his presence. For before the presence of his glory with exceeding joy. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Isn't that good?
Yes.
My. I'm going with him.
Yes.
I'm going to do what he said. Yes. That these verses of scripture are hooked up with the first verse of scripture. Contending for the faith that was once delivered unto the saints and not listening to these people who got sin going on in their life. And that's the sum total of what he's saying. Don't listen to these people. If they got sin going on in their life, if they're in any way giving you a license to sin, condoning sin, saying give you an excuse for sin, somehow making it all right to where that is something that is an everyday occurrence and it's normal, do you run from them? You run from them. They're under the judgment of God.
Right.
You lay hold on this wonderful life that God has given us. His life, praise God. His purity, his glory. Now, and then find yourself being kept by the power of God to the only wise God, our Savior. Be glory and majesty and dominion and power both now. Be glory and majesty and dominion and power both now. Oh God, have glory and power and dominion and majesty over my life.
Yes.
You controlling me. I want to be controlled by you. I'm under the control of righteousness.
Hallelujah.
I was under the control of sin. I'm under the control of righteousness right now. Praise God. People, the very most important thing is for you and I to begin to cry out to God and recognize that conviction is a lost state in the church. It's hardly even felt.
Yeah.
Everybody wants to feel good.
Mm.
You don't get to feel good till you feel right, till you made right.
That's right.
Amen.
Redemption brings a wholeness and a completeness. It doesn't leave us partially saved or trying to still be worked on and fixed so we can be right. We're going to have to, listen, if there's anything we need to press in for, if there's anything that we need to pray, if there's anything we need to cry out to God for, so anything we need to give ourselves to is that realm of Holy Ghost conviction. The Spirit of the Lord is the one who convinces everyone of sin, but he uses our mouth. He uses our mouth. The Holy Spirit convinces everybody of sin. That's his work. But he uses our mouth. And he uses our mouth by saying for us to declare God's word, to declare the whole counsel of God. Because if we don't preach, how shall they know? How shall they hear? If we don't declare and make a distinction between that which is good and that which is evil, that which is righteous and that which is unrighteous, that which is acceptable God and that which the wrath of God abides on, then how will they ever hear? That is the job for the priest and the prophet and the minister. Us. People say, oh, just leave them to Holy Ghost conviction. Are you kidding me? Where did you get that at? That is a huge contradiction to what you just said a few minutes ago. Preacher, Holy Ghost conviction is going to come because you're going to now become, quote unquote, a condemnation preacher. You're going to tell people their sins. You're going to tell them to flee from the wrath of God. If they got this stuff going on in their life, I'm going to tell you right now, the wrath of God abides on it. Don't have it. Don't allow it.
Amen.
To fortify them. To strengthen them.
Yeah.
To heal the sheep.
Yeah.
In Jesus' name, everybody stand with me. Hallelujah. God is good, isn't he?
Yeah.
Isn't it wonderful now? Isn't it wonderful? I love that. Now unto him who is able to keep you from falling. And to present you faultless. I love it. I love it. You know, those are the wonderful songs. There's a wonderful verse of scripture we write songs about.
Amen.
And that we just love singing it.
Yeah.
Singing unto him who's able to keep you from stumbling, to present you faultless before the presence of his glory with exceeding joy. I don't have to memorize that. I feel that. You know what I'm saying? I never set out to memorize this verse. I just read it so many times, I want that. You know, when you really want it, you don't forget it. You saw a beautiful place, you can remember how to get there.
Yep.
You know what? You don't need a map. I remember how to get there. It was amazing. Now unto him who's able to keep me from slipping, from stumbling. Oh, my God. Who preserves me and keeps me under. Because we're kept by the power of God right now through faith unto salvation, ready to be revealed. I'm ready. I'm not hoping I'm getting ready. I'm ready. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
God wants to bring you this joy and peace because there's nothing on earth to compare. You can sit around with piles of silver dollars and gold 1-ounce coins and dollar bills stacked to the ceiling and all the other little things that you like and heap them on top of yourself and wall around them and roll around them. You're going to be as miserable, more miserable than you can ever imagine. Only God can bring you joy.
True. Yeah. True.
Only God.
Yeah.
True. All these other things, they're meaningless.
True.
What do you really get out of it anyways?
Yeah.
Huh? You only like it because you're so bored. You get caught away in God, you're going to be so full of excitement. You're going to be on the grand adventure, man. Hallelujah. We on the grand adventure, aren't we?
Yes, we are.
We on the grand adventure. Hallelujah.
Thank you, Jesus.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Pastor Daniel and Pastor Summer. I mean, people, we're going to get this building up.
Amen.
We pressing it. Daniel's been just on the lead over there trying to get things moving along in the planning department so we can actually get the building up. It's on the ground. We got everything pretty much ready. Mom and I are going to leave tomorrow. We're going to go and we're going to get some stuff done.
Amen.
I'm going to get on that backhoe and I'm going to tear things apart, man. You know, that's one thing about moving mountains. You get a bit on a big old D8. Mountain, get out the way right now. No, I'm not kidding you. I'm kidding you. Just set that blade, put it in high gear, throw the throttle to the floorboard, and just. I love it because I feel it in the spirit. That's just the way I am. It's full throttle. I'm not no half throttle.
Amen.
No quarter throttle.
Amen.
Boom. All the way to the floorboard, just wide open.
Yes.
Praise the name. Hi, baby. Come on now. We're seeing the Lord do great things. We're partnering also with Debbie, with Bob and Debbie, for the Bible school up in Aberdeen, and we're a part of that. We're already involved in it. In fact, Debbie and I are going to do a meeting together in Switzerland this year.
Awesome.
And, you know, Pat and I are doing meetings together, and there's other things that God has opened up for us to do as companies of people, companies of ministers.
Hallelujah.
I love it. I love it.
Thank you.
And I'm blessed that every one of you just faithfully be a part of it, because I mean, goodness, you know, you sowed in to when Evangelist Tim Hall was here, and God's using Tim in wonderful ways. And, you know, I've been on his board for a long time. In fact, I'm the chairman of his board. He's supposed to be the chairman. And, you know, he's also provides oversight to the ministry along with a host of other wonderful men of God. I mean, we're not sitting here dangling around on our own. We're not. I mean, we got a troop. We got a troop. But I'm not going to compromise the message either, so the place will be full. I'm going to let Papa fill it up with the message. I want to babysit a bunch of disgruntled people anyway. Play patty cake with their demons. You know what I'm saying? No lukewarmers. I'll tell you right now. And the preacher asked me one time, he said, how do you keep the deadwood out? I said, keep the fire on. He said, I got it. That's pretty simple. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Listen, we love you, people. We love you. The things that we do and things we say, we're going to say it out of love.
Yeah.
We're going to say it out of a consecration. We're going to say it out of a commitment, first and foremost, to Him. Because if we'll do it His way, we'll have the full display of His glory and His power in the day of His working. Yes. I believe that there can continually flow in revival and moves of God, but there are also sovereign moves of God. I'm going to tell you, you know, it's like I've had these kinds of events. Others have had these kinds of events. Debbie was telling me one time, because it was in 1990. She told me what she did, and I said, it was either, I told her, I said, you did that in 1997, didn't you? She said, yeah, it was 1997. Why? Why did I say it? Because in 1997, there was a sovereign moving of God throughout the earth. And she was preaching, and it was a big meeting, and it was mostly all pastors and leaders. She opened up the Bible, and all she did was say, turn in your Bibles to Acts chapter 2. And when she said that, people were, all the preachers were propelled by the power of God out of their chairs. They were all flat out under the power of God. Everybody weeping, hollering, screaming. Because it's doing what God said to do in the day of His power.
Yes.
In the sovereign movings of God. We always in a move of God. When I discovered I can have a move of God, I'm always have a move of God. I'm always have the presence of God. I'm always have signs and wonders and miracles. I'm always have that tangible presence of His glory. I'm always have display of His authority and of His power. But listen, I've been in too many sovereign moves of God. The movings of God. I believe that people do things that shut it down prematurely. But God has mercy. It's like another wave. Huh? It's like you're sitting out there and you're going, somebody needs to put another quarter in. Because you know you had a lot of these waves coming, now just this big lull, and then suddenly somebody looks out on the horizon and says, outside, and it's a big enough day that you know you got to give it full power, huh? Right? And you look over, way over, and the indicator's going off, and you know, oh no, you're still not out far enough, huh? Come on, man, I feel it. Feel it.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. I hate paddling in. You know what I mean?
Yes.
The law came and it's just like it just stayed the law. You just paddled in. Ooh, I'm not paddling in. Those of you that are not surfers, I'm sorry. But I'm sure you can get it. You've watched the ocean enough. Great wave in the Holy Ghost is coming. Father made those waves. It's His terminology. Yeah. Nothing to do with the culture of surfing. Just His terminology. I'm not in the culture of surfing. I just like to go out and ride the waves. You're with me. Are you with me? Takura si tala mo sabranga estipele katuna. Hallelujah. Just lift your hands towards heaven. Let Papa touch you. Father, I thank You for these anointed ones that are in this place. These people who are consecrated and committed to You, who are willing to build themselves up in the most holy faith. Father, I pray in the name of Jesus that every person in this place with greater urgency will give themselves to the study of the Word, the reading of the Word, the ministry of the Word, that they won't just take these things for granted, but will recognize the urgency of the hour and of the time. And oh, hallelujah. Hallelujah. Jesus is here. Christ Jesus is here right now. The power of the living God is present in this place. Wow. Wow. God loves you with an everlasting love. He's done everything He could possibly do to secure your place with Him. All you've got to do is respond with all of your heart and determine in your heart that you're going to remove yourself from everything that is ungodly. You know, I was thinking about Abraham today when it got so bad that God had to destroy Sodom and Gomorrah. He chose to live in the mountains apart from it. And He told Lot, He said, you be careful going down into the plains. The people are wicked. They have no fear of God. You get down in there, you're going to be influenced by them. He told Solomon, don't you take unto yourself wives. that belong to other nations. They will influence you. You people have got it here. You've got to watch out what you allow to come into your life. You got to watch out what you set in front of you. You got to watch out what you partake of. I'm going to tell you right now, something's overcoming you. Get out of its way. Get out of its way. Get out of its way. Person told me the other day, well, we're trying to deal with this thing, can't get dealt with, and keeps overcoming us, and this and that and the other thing. I said, well, listen, just do this. Just get rid of the computer and get rid of the iPhone. And then they had the audacity to say to me, well, we don't want to be manipulated by Satan. I'm like, what? You're being overcome by Satan. You say you're going to be manipulated, that now you're going to be manipulated by Satan. Listen to this logic, that if we have to get rid of our computer and our iPhone that's causing us to view pornography, then we've been manipulated by Satan. We should be able to have it and overcome it. Well, you might should be, but you're not, so crush it. Come on, people. We're going to have to get out of this funny logic and just do what we need to do. And just have a revival where everybody brings their books and brings their unholy things and brings, you know, that's one of the things I just loved about Reinhardt. When they would have those big meetings, he would have everybody come and bring their filth and bring their trash and bring the stuff that belonged to sin and iniquity and burn it. It was like every Friday night there was a big barrel burn. Fire was going off. That's so good. People, listen, let's go for God. Let's go for the movings of God. It's a cost. There's a price. There's a commitment. There's a consecration. And here, in this place, you know how to move with the Spirit of the Lord, and you know how to move with the movings of God. And for you not to lay hold of the power to be an overcomer, you are far more responsible than the people who sit in the Episcopal Church who've never felt the presence of God or the movings of God. They've never been led into experiencing His joy and His glory and being overwhelmed by His love. But you and I, we have. And the responsibility is far greater to us to say, wait a minute, I have tasted Him. I have touched Him. Somebody in this place said, well, I don't know that I've ever experienced the presence of God. Well, you know what? You may not have, but everybody else here has. Hello. Wouldn't you think that would invalidate what they said? That they would go around and ask everybody, have you really experienced the presence of God? And then listen to everybody say, yeah, I really have. And then by the time you got finished interviewing everybody, your experience should be invalidated. In any other dimension of life, it would be. If you're standing in a company of 50 people to 100 people, and everybody's experienced the presence of God except for you, are you going to say that what they experienced wasn't true and what you haven't experienced is? Fuzzy logic again. I'm helping somebody here right now. I really am. It's time you wake up. It's time you wise up. Smarty pants. In Jesus' name. God loves you. Settle it, people. Settle it. I want you to go with God's word and the exactness of His word, because I'm telling you right now, that is what He demands. And from this day forward, you recognize that if you allow sin in your life, it's a proof that you're not right with God. And then you'll get down on your knees until you get right with God. You do whatever it takes to get right with God. As I said this morning, if you really believe that God is there and that He's giving you an opportunity to have His life and to have His favor and to have His presence and to have His protection and have His glory and have all these things that He has given to us, you would do anything. Whatever He asked. And He's not asked a hard thing for us. He's asked us to love Him. He's asked us to walk with Him. He's asked us to submit ourselves to Him and resist the devil. He's asked us to give ourselves over to His way of life and to deny worldly lust and ungodliness. He's not asked much. He's asked us to start loving and stop hating. Amen. He's asked us to start blessing and stop abusing. Hello. What a God. And there is no God besides him. There was no God created before him, and there's no God created after him. There is none. He knows of none. None. There is no other. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. God is our God. He's a mighty God, and I pray in the name of Jesus, every one of you will have an encounter with him. That you will encounter him in greater depths of intimacy than ever before. I pray tonight that you lay down and go to bed and you say, Lord, I just want your visions and I want your dreams. Speak to me tonight. I pray that you'll wake up in the morning and say, Lord, I yield myself to you. I just want to be a witness. I want to be everything that you purposed me to be, to live the life that you've given me to live. Protect me and keep me, lead me and guide me. I give myself completely over to you. He will. He will, people. It's got to become more important to you, though. And as long as salvation is cheap, you're going to treat it so. But when it becomes to you, the priceless, and most valuable thing, richest thing, most glorious thing that exists, you won't take it for granted anymore. In Jesus' name. Jesus. Jesus. If there's anybody in here tonight, you want to get right with God, you're not right with God, you want to get right with God, tonight's the night to get right with God. I'm not doing a head count. God is. Tonight, if you're not right with God, God wants you to get right with him. You can get right with him right there where you stand. But I want to pray with you. I want to hook up faith with you. I want to grab a hold of you and ask God to save you as real as he saved me. To change you as radically as he changed me. I want you to have the salvation that Christ Jesus brings. Whether you're standing in here or you're watching on the web or YouTube, he's close to you. He's right there. When you call on him with a true and sincere heart, he will answer you. He'll change you. He'll fill you with his goodness. He'll fill you with his love. He'll fill you with his life. If you're not burned out on your own life, and you're still hanging on to whatever it is you're hanging on to, shame on you. Go ahead and play with it a little bit longer if you want. Ain't gonna get you anywhere. It's just gonna make you more sad. God's inviting you into his life. Surrender to him. Just believe him. Every mind-blinding spirit's out of your way. Every power of darkness is out of your way. There's no reason why you shouldn't turn your life over to God. You can't fight the scripture. You can't say, well, hey, but this other preacher told me, and what makes you right and him wrong? The word of God. It's not about me being right and him being wrong. It's about what does the word of God say. It's what does God's word say. I pray in the name of Jesus Christ, everything changes for you. No matter who you are standing here tonight, whether you have a rich, deep hold of God, living in a glory and a manifest presence of his power and the richness of the Spirit flowing through your life and the expressions of all of his gifts, still there's a deeper depth. All of the dimensions of God. There is no end to the height, no bottom to the depth. Amen. No end to the length. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Oh, hallelujah. 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 If you're sad, quit being sad and start being glad. Because the redeemed of the Lord are glad. So if you're sad, I question your redemption. Because the redeemed of the Lord are glad. And when I recognize that, I'm going to say, you won't be glad, buddy. You won't be glad right now. Oh, hallelujah. I tell you right now, you get to acting like you're redeemed right away. God makes sure that it's true. You continue to go in your own way. You want to do it your own way. You want to have your own unholy emotions instead of his holy emotions. Listen. You choosing not to obey God. You're choosing to walk in your own way. Don't do that anymore. Submit yourself to God. Yield to Him. Hallelujah. You sick? Be healed right now. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Praise the name of Jesus. Praise the name of Jesus. Katarabo shikanda bahate. Praise the name of Jesus. Praise Him. Oh, praise Him, all ye flesh. Praise Him, sun, moon, and stars. Praise Him, all ye who have breath. Praise Him. Praise Him and don't stop praising Him. Shout and don't stop shouting. Dance and don't stop dancing. Praise and don't stop praising. Flow and don't stop flowing. Yield and don't stop yielding. Hallelujah. 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 Lord, we praise You. We worship You. Lord, we give thanks unto You. Oh, we magnify Your name. Holy Spirit, take control. Lord Jesus, be glorified. Father, Your will be done in my life. So I won't stop shouting, and I won't stop dancing, and I won't stop praising, and I won't stop flowing, and I won't stop yielding to Him. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Listen, come and worship Him tonight, the one who is able to keep you from falling. As long as we're willing, He's able. Thank You, Father. Thank You, Father, that You keep me from falling. Thank You, Father, that I'm kept by Your power. Thank You, Father, that You watch over me, that Your eyes are set upon me. Lord, that You uphold me, that You don't allow me to stumble, that You're ministering to me in entrance. Lord, I want to understand how to get in that realm. I'm going to give myself over to everything You ask me to. I'm going to give myself to the purity. I'm going to give myself to patience. I'm going to give myself to godliness. I'm going to beat everything up. Come along, say something different. Hallelujah. Come on, man. Hallelujah. Listen, God's going to use you to take nations, but you got to start off with your own brain. What's going on in your own head, your own life, your own thoughts? You subdue that, and after that, it's all downhill from there, folks. Amen. You deal with the lying, condemning things, the things that would lead you away from God. You just resist the devil steadfast in the faith. I'm telling you, it's all downhill from there. Father, use you to do great things. Hallelujah. Praise the name of the Lord. He is. Be confident in God. Demand it of yourself. And if you sin, and you've got this kind of consecration and awareness of God, you just repent quickly. You won't just repent lightly. You'll repent ferociously. Because you recognize that, my goodness, this is everything opposite of who you're supposed to be. And it changed the whole dynamics of your interaction with God. Are you listening to me? I promise you it'll create a resolve within you to walk perfectly before the Lord. Lay hold on that power of God that has been given to you. Amen. Find a bunch of people around you. Tell them that you love them. Hug them. Bless them in Jesus' name. If anybody wants prayer, we're here to pray with you and for you. If there's anybody in here tonight, you lost, you don't know God, you're not certain if you're right with God, He's here to touch you, change you, feel you. He's good God. Hallelujah. He's not turning anybody away. He's invited all sinners to come.